Much as I find myself to be a summer weather type of gal, there's one thing I adore about the coldest season of them all. Snow. Beautiful, ephemeral ice falling from the sky, filled with as much life as it is death, helping some flora to thrive and some fauna to perish. And then, one day, it begins to end. Sometimes without hesitation, and others with a slow decay, until none of it is left but the survivors and the traces of the withered.
Even just the fin discussion of the game about the cover, I'm hardly the first person to point out there's something very emblematic of the human experience within that cycle. Things good and bad can suddenly come into our lives that feel defining and inescapable, wedging themselves into our albums of memories until one day, as a dear friend of mine likes to say, all comes to pass. Whether it's by an abrupt stop or a sickening decay, all things can come to pass just as the beautiful white snow does. And as this season now draws to a close where I reside in the United States, I want to share a story with everyone about just this. A story of the worst and best within people. A story of our greatest failures to communicate and our greatest achievements to overcome ourselves. A story where the snow seemed as if it was never going to melt for some. A story of the season of all our white albums.
Written by Saigano off Marito Fumiaki, White Album 2 has garnered a reputation as one of the most beloved visual novels of all time, no doubt the result of such a beloved offer getting to work with one of the most important and prolific VN studios of all time, Leaf. Despite being a numbered sequel, however, White Album 2 is more of a spiritual successor, taking many of the core themes and vibes of the original while following an unrelated cast, using soap opera tropes and vibrant, realistic characters to ask a simple question. What if a skull love triangle never ended? The result is a deeply human and relatable story that, at its core, wants to explore the worst in how we connect to other people, while all still maintaining a hope that, like the snow fading, all can come to pass. It is the soap to rule them all, invigorating, engaging, suspenseful, painful, heartwarming, and deeply reflective, while still being full of meaning and purpose, crammed into an astoundingly well-paced 80-hour package. So it's no surprise it's garnered the success that it has. The two separately released portions of the story, introductory chapter in 2010 and closing chapter in 2011, hit the top 20 on PC in their respective years, kept alive with a steady slew of re-releases, console ports, light novels, drama CDs, and even an anime adaptation, which tells a slightly different view of the first chapter's events. Oh, and there's a ton of merchandising. Much as I would love to tell you about Setsuna's girl smell by using her branded perfume, I'm mostly going to be passing over to fluff and focusing only on what's included within the definitive version of the game, Extended Edition. Spread across three DVDs, this release includes both chapters, the fan disc, the console-exclusive episodes, all the audio dramas, and all the digital novels, making it by far the best release to get. While you can get that digitally for around 6,500 yen, physical copies not only tend to go for less money, but are easier to get in a lot of countries due to the way the distributor, DMM, gates their online content outside of Japan. In comparison, getting a hold of the physical copy is as easy as pie, thanks to today's sponsor, Zen Market.
Ordering things from Japan is famously not the easiest task. Interfaces can be confusing to navigate, communication can be challenging, international fees can get absurd, and some places exaggerate their shipping fees to a wild degree. But that's where Zen Market stepped in for me, and can for you too. With an easy-to-use interface that integrates searching and auto-translating on popular sites like Yahoo Auctions and Amazon Japan, Zen Market takes all of the stress out of shopping from anywhere online in Japan by managing everything for you. Shopping is as simple as picking an item, adding it to your cart, paying by your method of choice, and letting them handle the rest, all for just a 500 yen service fee per item. Even if you want to order something from a niche site, like this outfit from Ankh Rouge I'm wearing now, you can request a custom order with a super simple form. Anything you purchase can then be stored in their warehouse for up to 60 days to collect with other items, before shipping it all to your address in a single wonderfully packed box, with some of the lowest shipping rates around from one of 8 providers. No matter where you live, Zen Market has you and over 2 million other customers covered, even offering customer support in over a dozen languages. Of the many proxies I've tried, Zen Market is simply the best, and one that I'm happy to recommend to all of you, even more so than usual for this video as they've provided a discount code just for viewers of this channel. By following the link in the description with code Amelie Doree to create an account, you'll get an extra sign-up bonus adding up to a total of 750 yen worth of points to use on shipping a parcel on top of any other promotions they might be running.
A massive thanks goes to them for sponsoring this video. As I've said in the past, I don't take on sponsorships for products and services I don't personally believe in, so trust me when I say that whether I'm ordering games, art books, or anything in between for this channel, or even stuff like posters for myself, Zen Market has never let me down in the years I've been using them.
Now, with all that said, I think it's finally time to dive into why this game has garnered so much acclaim, and what it has to say about how we bond to other people and the passage of time.
White Album 2 is set in the late 2000s and follows the perspective of one Haruki Kitahara, last representative at Hojo High, straight-A student, and guitarist in Light Music Club, which starts to crumble as soon as the game begins, leaving behind only him and lifelong bro club slacker Takuya Iizuka. With a concert for the school festival coming up soon, the two rush to get the club together and find themselves in the company of people they could have never expected. By pure luck, as Haruki is idly practicing the song White Album by Rina Ogata on his guitar one day, he hears the beautiful voice of a girl and the stunning playing of a pianist join in harmony. The former turns out to be the beloved school idol and two-time winner of the title Miss Hojo, Setsuna Ogiso, a friendly, sweet, outgoing, and talented girl whom Haruki immediately hits it off with and slowly becomes closer to. The latter turns out to be Kazu Satoma, the daughter of a world-famous artist, an absentee student, and a talented pianist with a heart of gold and a cold exterior, who soon finds herself begrudgingly tagging along with Setsuna and Haruki, all three eventually promising that they'll stay together forever as close and caring friends. That bond is soon tested, however, by the growing romantic tensions between the three of them and Setsuna's sudden confession of love to Haruki on the night of their successful concert. A concert so successful that it would come to be one of the most famous days in the school's history and one of the defining points of their lives. And it's that confession which leads everything to crumble. With one romance built on a desperation to stay together with others and another that was meant to be but knowingly sabotaged, engaged with only as a short affair, their high school lives end in disaster with their trust betrayed and Kazusa gone from their lives to pursue her artist career in Vienna, thus setting the stage for the next 5 years of each of their lives. With Haruki holding his love for the now faraway Kazusa in his heart, and Setsuna unwilling to let go of him, the two enter into a stalemate which affects every aspect of their lives. Through his college years of other equally troubled partners presenting themselves, and through his adult years of sudden twists and turns opening up old wounds and desires, Haruki is left both to navigate life with a love left unfulfilled and a love gone too long. Relationships built on lies and betrayals from both sides, and to somehow find happiness on the other end, no matter the cost and the struggles. Like I stated in the intro just a moment ago, White Album 2 is very distinctly not a sequel to White Album, instead opting to hone in on what Maruto found most interesting about the original, what he describes as a feeling of powerlessness and being carried along by the protagonist's circumstances. As a result, you won't be seeing anything to do with Yuki and Rina at all, though there are still ties here by way of tunes from it becoming major plot points and thematic symbols. The most obvious example is probably the song White Album from White Album being a major part of White Album 2. White Album 1 is a game that's noted for being janky in its original incarnation and dated even in its remake form, so I welcome the change of pace brought here. And WA2 is very, very functional as a standalone work, though a damned expansive one at that, being told across a whole 3 chapters. There's introductory chapter, closing chapter, and coda, each taking 15, 40, and 30 hours or thereabouts respectively. The first chronicles the three characters' last year of high school and how things came to crumble, the second follows their college years of Setsuna and Haruki in an awkward relationship limbo, and the third is in their adult years where Kazusa makes a reappearance just as Setsuna and Haruki begin to find a facsimile of normalcy, and everything crumbles again. Because the latter two are where the bulk of White Album 2's story lies, they're what I'm going to be focusing on for much of this video. That isn't to say Icy isn't important though, because it is. Not only is it a great story on its own, but it contains much of the story's foundation and sets precedent for many of the events to come, from character motives to life choices. Which is good, as White Album 2 is premised almost entirely on that. I say almost because Maruto does do a stunning job at making the world feel alive and vast. Just like the previously reviewed Parfait, everything that's fictionalized, from the schools to the shops to the cafes, feels real and lively, populated by side characters and little occurrences outside of the main plot which all bear meaning. They all feel like actual places, adding a lot to the game's sense of realism. And though the game is still thoroughly grounded in a 2000s Japan setting and culture, it's not to any extent that I'd say is alienating potential readers. If you're into anime enough to read visual novels, you probably know enough about Japan to understand why there's tension inherent in our protagonist wanting to ditch a relationship with a girl who appears to be outwardly perfect for something even vaguely risky, as well as why it sees themes like an overbearing obligation to society and family, and escaping into work as important to talk about. The focus on this more grounded world and these more grounded themes, along with the story's general optimism for humans to improve, does a lot to balance out the often chaotic and even gut-wrenching absurdity of the soap opera melodrama. You've got all your typical tropes here, not just a love triangle and all the bullshit that entails, but you've also got your sudden cancer diagnosis, you've got your petty preppy high school slut rumors, you've got your mastermind manipulator characters, and you've got your moments of pure shock as someone seems to gear up to do something absurd. It teeters a fine line between requiring readers to suspend their disbelief towards a bridge too far, and indulging engaging in absurdity for the sake of making compelling moments and gripping story threads to accentuate the character's believable emotional struggles. And it's because of this that the story never stops feeling genuine. People do ridiculous things, but it always makes sense in an objective or emotional way. It feels like what would happen if you put real, unpredictable, messy people in the plot beats of a J-drama. At the core of this is our protagonist and POV character, Haruki Kitahara. And rather than be the type of self-insert blank slate I've maligned numerous times on this channel, he's an incredibly well-defined character with an immense amount of agency to make his own decisions, undictated by choices given to the player. It's just unfortunate for his sake then that most of his own choices are horrible. Outwardly, Haruki gives and is desperate to maintain the appearance of a very socially adjusted person. He excelled in high school and college, he's well respected in every job he's worked, he's loved by his friends, mostly, and everyone views his relationship to Setsuna as ideal. In every way, he seems like the perfect salaryman who's aiming towards a perfect life, and everyone supports this vision of him. But that doesn't say a single thing about how he manages any of it, and his failure to be just that is a major source of tension with his friends. He's shown to escape into work when life gets hard, his friend group pressures him into staying in his relationship with Setsuna against his wishes, and that relationship is flawed, to put it lightly. Just on his end alone, he regularly conceals things from her, lies about his feelings towards other women, and generally does not seem to want to be with her, but does so out of obligation from society, and her obsession with not letting go. He fucks up a lot with other people, but make no mistake, the man is stuck between a heat-seeking rock and a hard place. It's just that his response is to run away from the rock that'll just find him again, getting involved in all sorts of relationships and life affairs that serve to further complicate the situation, until he inevitably has to confront the rock head-on in each route's climax. So just what is the rock cooking? Setsuna Ogiso is one of the two main heroines of White Album 2, and the character who's either going to make or break the story for you given how much revolves around her, enough for people to write entire essays. Much like Haruki, she appears on the surface to be a societal ideal and perhaps even surpass that, but beneath that is someone who is thoroughly broken. As a school idol, she's well beloved for her looks as well as her voice after the concert. As a daughter, she's well loved by her brother and parents and her nuclear family, and as a girlfriend, she appears sweet, gentle, responsive, and capable of caring for all of her boyfriend's needs, while still able to be a self-sufficient career woman if she so desires. And yet, as a school idol, she's garnered an image as a perfect beauty that she herself feels at odds with. As a daughter, her family is highly controlling and has isolated her from any sort of independence, and as a girlfriend, her upbringing and environment has turned her into a partner who is calculating, manipulative, controlling, and desperate to maintain the control of a life that's been denied to her. Much of the drama of White Album 2 and the challenges other characters face come from exactly this. Setsuna idealizes the so-called perfect days at the start of her relationship with Haruki and the midpoint of her friendship with Kazusa in an introductory chapter, and refuses to move on from it, more or less trapping Haruki through guilt-tripping that even she is often unaware of doing. It's a relationship that she often seems to genuinely despise, bouncing between unvoiced hatred and love for Haruki, coded in a mixture of shame and a lack of self-awareness. While those aspects of her are present from the very start of the game, it's at the very end of IC and leading into CC that they really start to blossom, seeing her boyfriend kissed the pianist in front of her eyes, only further strengthening her fears of abandonment from her childhood. I have seen other reviewers point out that Setsuna's personality and traits very strongly resemble the diagnosis criteria for borderline personality disorder, and that is not something I can deny at all. The kind of I hate you, don't leave me approach she takes with Haruki, the intense emotional swings, the subconscious manipulation, all out of an overwhelming desire to not be left behind by past trauma, are very much clinical symptoms and origins of BPD, and ones that I know very well. I've been in therapy for years for basically exactly these, with a lot of the same points of origin. A sheltered childhood combined with being seen as a golden kid incapable of wrong does some pretty fucking horrible things to a person that can very well lead to them meeting a lot of the criteria for cluster B disorders like borderline and narcissistic. And for the people living with those, as Setsuna seems to be, it sucks. It's miserable to feel like you're fighting your own mind and overwhelming intense emotions that you know are wrong and going to hurt others, but you're at no leisure to just simply deny. I can personally attest that a strong support network that understands the issues, along with therapy to actively work on the bad habits so you don't harm others, can do a lot to heal those issues to the point that they aren't a problem for other people. They do not define a person if a person acts to not let them, because at the core of many people suffering from these disorders are people who want to be safe and make others happy. And that core can be fostered. Which is not to say those destructive actions and the outcomes of paranoia aren't abuse, because abuse isn't defined by good or bad intentions, it's defined by outcomes and actions. Why I think Setsuna's character works here, then, is that she really captures this. She's far more than a simple caricature of someone struggling with themselves. And as much as I love offers attempting to write characters who canonically deal with disorders like depression, bipolar anxiety, PTSD, borderline, and so on, I think writers who hone in on those often end up making stereotypes based on definitions. Beyond that alone just kinda leading to stale character writing, those definitions are always shifting around. An example relevant here is the scholarly discourse as to whether or not BPD is actually related to complex PTSD, or potentially even just an incredibly extreme form of it, as the two have a lot of similar symptoms and speculated origin points. As many scholars are now arguing, the disorderly part of BPD is mostly to do with how that PTSD manifests in very destructive interpersonal habits, though that isn't always present for BPD since primarily self-destructive tendencies are an important part too. As much as it can be good to see people with these things represented to alleviate the feelings of being alone or unlike anyone else, you still have to represent these things as parts of a real person. After all, the real people who have faced these experiences, which serve as the basis for these diagnostic criteria, are still real people at the end of the day, and it's easy as a writer to forget there's more to people with disabilities than their labeled disabilities. With Setsuna only being implied by actions to be BPD, this could easily turn into an entire discussion on characters being coded and whether or not that counts as genuine representation. But that's not a theme of the work, so I'm gonna avoid getting into the weeds on that. All I'll say is the DSM is some bullshit societal construct and representation is way more than a label. My point in all of this is that I think Setsuna is a more engrossing character for Marito, seeming to put personhood above categorization. A wonderfully complex mess who bounces between utterly despicable and lovable and does more than anyone else to keep the perpetual J-drama engine going with her own flaws. It makes Kazuha more interesting by comparison, as her approach to the unrequited love isn't to guilt Haruki into staying, but to retreat into the only thing she knows and escape from everything, her piano. Because of this, she's entirely absent from closing chapter with exception to a cameo, and only directly appears for the first and third acts of the game, but this doesn't stop her from having importance. Haruki will inevitably do a Haruki and long for her, but that longing can disperse in any number of ways based on the route the player is currently exploring in CC. However, once the two lock eyes again for the first time in years in Coda, it all comes back in full force, and with it, her longing as well, leading them to make some very questionable decisions to try and experience each other's warmth once again. Similar to Setsuna, Kazusa has a deep fear of being alone, though for different reasons. Daughter of a world-famous pianist who is too busy touring to give her any attention, left with no dad to be raised by and unable to get along with pretty much anybody at school, she develops no practical or interpersonal skills as a child and spent her teenage years in high schools neglecting any duty that doesn't have to do with her singular skill. That, then, sets the stage for her own strong attachment to Haruki. His persistence in attempting to gain her friendship worked, even if she was unable to show it. Maybe almost too well, as she fell in love with him and found herself unable to express it before Setsuna swooped in to take him for herself. And yet, despite knowing the two are together, she still aims towards engaging with him sexually and romantically to fill her own heart for the briefest of moments, culminating in an introductory chapter of the airport kiss and some very painful sequences in Coda. Her character is marked by personal tragedy after personal tragedy that all revolves around a singular person, her inability to state her emotions towards them before it's too late, and another woman who actively meddles in it for her own peace of mind. But she deals with those emotions in a very different way than the other two. Unlike Haruki, who lies to everyone out of fear, and unlike Setsuna, who manipulates everyone and denies herself her emotions, Kazusa seems to accept them and quietly struggles with them, sometimes lashing out at others with unrelated reasons as an excuse, until eventually the truth comes out. Deep down though, she is a needy, childish person who wants to be cared for and to have those parts of her which had never been nurtured before cared for. It makes for a fascinating character and one that has a hell of a lot of chemistry with Haruki when she's actually being honest. The two bicker and banter back and forth at each other like a married couple in dialogue that feels far more familial, trusting, and close-knit than his with Setsuna. Comparatively, theirs often feels coded in an anxiety about falling apart, desperate to be reassured of love and to be a couple that society deems as perfect. These three characters serve as the core of all of White Album 2's drama and tensions. Their decisions, personalities, and emotions echo in how the plot progresses both behind the scenes and right in front of the viewer's eyes through Haruki's POV, as even when they aren't present, the effect they have on him bleeds into the way he interacts with other people. With around 30 named characters, White Album 2 has a seriously impressive cast. Besides a trio, you've got three heroines to contend with, Haruki's co-workers, his friend group, and a bunch of other supporting actors ranging from parents to teachers. It can be a bit much sometimes, as I found myself mixing up names here and there, especially with Haruki's job, but whether that's a flaw of the writing or me being bad with names like I usually am, I got no clue. It's probably the latter. The game still strives to keep the active cast generally small though, with some characters only present during specific routes or chapters. The most important of all these other characters are the heroines of closing chapter. Going in the route order that I followed, we first have Koharu Sugiura, a spry third-year high school student who acts as a class rep, tennis club manager, and a slight tsundere who gains an interest in Haruki, following him royally fucking up when a friend of hers confesses to him. Though initially brash, and rightfully so, as Haruki shot her friend down in the most painful way possible, she starts to warm up after learning more about him and becomes insistent on him taking responsibility not just for how he treated her friend, but for his failures to patch things up with Setsuna. Of course, when her route begins proper, things develop even more in a way as terrible as you might expect. Her path retreads much of what happens in IC to the main trio, but through a different perspective that forces Haruki to question just what progress looks like in a love triangle in a stalemate, as Koharu loses her friends, the respect of her classmates, and her sense of responsibility with those. The end conclusion it comes to is one that I think is simultaneously optimistic while still being deeply realistic, emblematic of White Album 2's outlook on humanity as a whole. As well as that, the route's just gripping for how it shows Koharu falling into a lot of the same traps that Haruki did as a vulnerable high school student, even earning her the nickname Little Haruki from Takeya. Following her is Marikazu Oka, a workaholic office lady who acts as the chief and staff at Haruki's magazine editing job. Though kind and appearing mature, she's someone full of hypocrisies, warning others not to escape into their work while doing it herself, deciding against having a family or even a relationship just to focus on her job, a thing that, by the logic of society, could not possibly betray or hurt her so as long as she commits to it. While her route might be the worst in closing chapters, she's still my favorite of the free side heroines. I love her snark that at points feels grown up and at others feels like hiding a kind of childish playful pettiness. Her insecurities about her age feel like they very realistically portray fears women have about being past what society considers their prime, and the themes about overworking and escape were some which resonated with me the most, at least out of the more minor ones. Putting grievances I'll get into later aside, her route is also the one that made me realize just how great Marito is at writing mature, complicated women without just dumping a whole pamphlet of information about them on you. Her dialogue and the gestures described by the prose fill in the blanks about why she is how she is without saying it to you outright. What's important is that she is a sweet person who struggles to work through her life, feeling sadness over a lack of love at her age, an age society deems far too gone to ever find love. It's smart writing that allows her to simply be a character in the present tense as both Haruki and the readers come to know her, and that careful style of writing is further reflected within Chiaki's route. Though Haruki doesn't make a lot of new friends in Hojo University, one of the few he does is his classmate Chiaki Izumi. Bright, chipper, and absurdly flirty, he regularly attempts to help her out with her studies to some avail, but for the most part, the two just banter at school and she occasionally crashes at his place, leading to moments of hijinks and heartwarming in equal parts. She is by far the most mysterious character of the game until you get to her route proper, often failing to show up for class, refusing to say anything about what she's actually trying to accomplish or how she even spends her spare time, and seeming to have some ties to Haruki's past that are wholly unclear until the game pulls one of its most interesting structural tricks. But we'll get to that. She also, like Haruki in his high school years and like Koharu, attempts to meddle in the affairs of others constantly. But unlike past tense Haruki and present tense Koharu, what exactly she's doing in those isn't clear. There is some genuine mystery around her motives, and the way it gets resolved once you finally get to her true route is gut-wrenching to say the least. Really, the only thing that may let these free heroines down for some people is the fact that their stories do just end with closing chapter. Much as I dislike calling them side heroines like others are inclined to, as their routes are highly fleshed out and given the same level of content as the two main heroines in the final chapter, I can't really contest that language as only Setsuna's route continues into that chapter. Maybe, to balance things out though, Setsuna's route is pretty thematically dull as it mostly exists to segue into Coda. What I will contest, however, is some people saying these routes just aren't worth reading, which is like, why? Each and every one expands on the game's core themes, brings smaller ones to light, and work to show different sides of Haruki and Setsuna's characters through various what-ifs. What if he had the chance to help someone escape terrible high school drama he's all too familiar with? What if Haruki was forced to contend with parts of people he doesn't know at all? What if he didn't know what in the person he loves is real or fake? Those are all important questions that do come back in Coda, and I think you're seriously missing a huge part of the game if you decide to just skip out on these routes. I also love how these characters are more important to the story than just side attractions, as they all play pretty major roles in the true paths and in changing Haruki as a person. Whether or not Haruki decides to make the objectively correct decision and enter a loving relationship with an extremely pretty older office lady who needs to be reminded she's lovely and deserves affection, Mari doesn't just vanish from the plot. Her life goes on however it was gonna go on, and even gives Haruki support in his time of need in CC. I talked about this in my video on Parfait as well, but I really respect the way in which Marito ensures that nobody's treated as a disposable object just to satisfy a player's desire for X type of pretty lady. It wants you to look at these characters as people who are going to have their thoughts and their says on whatever people decide to do, and ensures the narrative doesn't revolve around Haruki. Ironically, despite him being a more active protagonist antagonist than most VN protagonists, he's less important to the story than most of them. The game, by other methods, still ensures the narrative is bigger than him anyway, such as with the side characters. Maybe the most important of them, and two of the only ones who stay throughout all three chapters, are Takeya and Io. The former is Haruki's bro for life, a loud idiot who's open about his womanizing and flings, yet somehow still has his shit together way more than Haruki does up until any given root ending. The dude's got such a strong personality all on his own that he genuinely feels like he could be the protagonist of his own game. He's got this amazing on-screen presence and amazing banter of Haruki that clearly conveys those two have known each other for ages, but he's also more than capable of giving our protagonist a sermon when needed, and sometimes not when needed. Honestly, this guy should have gotten his own root. Nobody cares more about Haruki than he does. Stick with your bros. Likewise, Io too feels like she could have been a heroine in another world. Brash and tomboyish, loyal and attentive, she makes a perfect complement to Takeya's more rambunctious personality. Rather than totally contrasting it though, she behaves a lot like him, just without the womanizing and with a lot more common sense. The two together make for a genuinely compelling pair of childhood best friends, and the constant but very simple romantic tension with them adds some much needed brevity compared to all the bullshit Haruki deals with and causes, something you are always acutely aware of by following his POV. Maruto's garnered a pretty impressive reputation for himself over his career, starting off small with a couple of well-respected titles for Giga and hitting it big with the aforementioned rom-com masterpiece Parfait in 2005, as well as Damekoi with Studio Hermit in 2007, White Album 2 feels like the culmination of all of his experience up to that point in more than just the characters and story threads. The prose finds an astounding balance between being flowery, rhythmic, poetic, and detailed, while still being easy to read, simple, and casual. Every single line feels deliberate and careful without there ever being any nagging sense that you're missing some deeper meaning somewhere. That isn't to say you can't read deeply into any given line, because I sure did, but rather that there was no point in which I felt confused or overwhelmed. It was all very coherent and cohesive. Maruto has long shown that sense for how to take grandiosity and verbosity and distill it into something that feels casual. It's not the same kind of brief simplicity that you'd find in some, say, Izumi Banya titles like the previously covered Shinryuku Kimi and Manakashi, but rather something evocative, descriptive, and flowery while still quaint and compact, rhythmic and beating. Maybe the most notable trick to achieve this is one that Maruto had long been using, paired sentences of equal length using different proper nouns and or verbs to create contrast and rhythm. Sometimes they serve to show Haruki's conflicted thoughts, sometimes they're comedic, and other times there's something else entirely, but they're incredibly easy and quick to read at a glance thanks to the structural similarities. Much like the game's incredible use of metaphor and general sense for creating evocative descriptions, those pairings never fail to hit the player with a quick burst of emotion sometimes, and slam them with a whole explosion of it at others. What I find most impressive in all of this though is that it doesn't ever stop feeling like a person's thoughts. Like, I feel like with novels that want to come off as prosaic, it's easy to accidentally fall into the trap of being too verbose. H.P. Lovecraft is an easy example, as I'm sure viewers have heard more than enough times in these videos. Bless the man's work when it isn't being racist or homophobic or xenophobic or— but there were multiple points when I was reading some of his short stories that the narration started getting so grandiose and verbose that it no longer felt like a character's internal monologue or even diary. Like, look, I get verbose in my own journals when my brain sparks aren't going off, but this is a whole other level. In contrast, Haruki's thoughts never stop feeling like Haruki's thoughts, and at that, a person's thoughts. At no point does it become a journal or highly considered, instead always feeling like a stream of consciousness that, just like most people, happens to flow wonderfully at points and be crowded with unending anxiety at others. It's got a good sense for pace, too, with slower scenes often favoring dwelling on finer details, while more intense moments are carefully crafted to have prose leaning on ease of quick reading while still maintaining a flair. It is a remarkably well-oiled ride, never stopping for a second to give time for the reader to lose their immersion. It manages to be engrossing without throwing plot twists at the player every other scene, making even the most mundane moments feel meaningful and impactful, and by contrast, the big twists and events become more meaningful. This is also about where I should mention that White Album 2 is one of the rare instances of a game I've covered where an English translation actually exists, and it's alright nowadays. The first few versions of it were notably bad, but the latest release from Total Kanai PL, 1.0.3.0, is perfectly fine, preserving much of the meaning and flow of the original. It doesn't quite hit the same as the original script for me, but it's nevertheless a solid, recommendable way to experience the game and see what themes it wishes to explore. The key of those, as I understand it, and as I'll state over and over again in this video, is the unstoppable flow of progress. Time will move whether we want it to or not, and to move with it rather than remain in a discomforting yet familiar stillness often means making challenging decisions. But important to fleshing this out are two major concepts. The first is about the necessity of human communication and why that can be a challenging, often painful task, as people hurt each other through lies, manipulation, concealment, and a refusal to let go. Given that this is a game where cheating is one of the core focuses of the story, that makes total sense. But the way each and every single one of the roots takes the unrequited, elongated, and complicated emotions in a different direction is damned impressive. Human communication is a topic that I, as an autistic person with a personality disorder, find super fascinating, mostly because it's one of the most difficult to understand and bizarre things in the world to me. I talked immensely about it in my cross-channel video, and while I adore how that game explores it as it is basically the game's focus, I think the angle this title takes is interesting. A friend who is a huge help in proofreading and improving this script described it as Maruto focusing on the micro, while CC's writer, Tanaka Romeo, focuses on the macro. And while they were saying that with regards to how the games explore society trademark, I think it's both relevant and apt in this context still. Of equal importance, however, is an idea that I mentioned near the start of this essay, that society is an inescapable force which we are all beholden to. No matter how much we wish to escape, no matter how much we wish to run, the societies we live under will always interfere with our lives, and we will sooner or later be forced to confront them and forced to make the choice of whether to change or abide. A lot of White Album 2's drama comes from characters choosing the latter, unable to break from the expectations of a heteronormative and conservative society. Be with the perfect girl, fall in line, and so on, with progress only finally coming when these characters reevaluate themselves and their lives, confronting society head-on and deciding what is best for them. Simply, escaping is not an option, as Maruto describes wonderfully in a full quote that I pulled from earlier.
I like the feeling of being carried along by the protagonist's circumstances. There was nothing you could do, no way of fighting the flow of things. That powerlessness was a very strong pull for me. No matter how great your love is, there's no escaping from society. In fact, you mustn't run away from it. Just deciding on the spot to hop on a train, flee to some other country, and end it there, I have a hard time believing in a life for the characters after that point.
What White Album 2 showcases is that life doesn't end at those grand soap opera climaxes. A person doesn't stop mattering simply because they stop existing in our most frontal view of the world, and each and every single route hammers this idea down by showing a life after that climax, refusing to let anybody end their interpersonal struggles on a wholly hanging note. As much as I can wax poetic about White Album 2's writing qualities, though, there is something I can't avoid criticizing: the presentation. While I normally try not to be highly critical of games, knowing firsthand just how hard game development is, and also because I'm not a very pessimistic person, White Album 2 has been baffling me for 2 months straight as to just how, even in the game's most definitive form, it got to this point. Nevertheless, I want to try and highlight the positives along with the negatives, so let's just get into it. White Album 2's first act, introductory chapter, was illustrated primarily by Leaf veteran Takashi Nakamura, notable for his work on the Pia Carrot games prior to his hiring, and on games like Two Heart 2 afterwards. His style, at its peak, is actually one I'm really fond of. Though always very clearly refined, it's got this kind of rough and sketchy appearance that feels grounded, a perfect match for previous works like Thin and I, as well as for White Album 2. And White Album 2 Extended Edition does often show him at his peak. Many CGs have gorgeous coloring and lighting, it's soft yet well-defined and feels very realistic while still enjoying some leeway to be very colorful. There's also some really creative angles and usages of the widescreen format, which surprised me given how much of the industry decided Dutch angles were the only good use of a 16:9 aspect ratio. I also absolutely adore the look of characters here. Even before I could read Japanese or knew many names in the industry, I'd seen much of Takashi's artwork and loved how he could come up with characters who looked really stylish and distinct yet very grounded, and I think White Album 2 really exemplifies this. Much as I love games of very cartoony and anime character designs, there's really something beautiful about how this merges that with a more down-to-earth feel. Everyone here looks like, well, an average person. Setsuna is a typical cute preppy girl of stunning looks, Mari is your average sophisticated office lady, Takaya looks like an average dude who just likes fun, Haruki and his co-workers look like average salarymen, hell, even Setsuna's parents just look like people in their 40s or 50s, rather than people who got hit with the yossification ray. The character sprites as well are, in part, really nice. Takashi's stylized sense of anatomy comes through in full force, exaggerated in some ways but real in others. It is distinctly his style, and comparing it against something like Denny Nye shows a ton of growth as an artist, or heck, even the original White Album 2 for that matter. Wait, the original White Album 2? To say this game had a troubled development from the beginning is a bit of an understatement. Takashi was forced to perform double duty as both director and illustrator, and both really suffered as a result. Even the latest version of IC has some super awkward scripting at points, and even though the all-in-one releases coming out from December 2011 onwards amended some of the art, that is not much consolation for what players of the 2010 version had to see. And I do have to be specific that only some of the art got improved, there's still tons that isn't redrawn, or is partially redrawn. And you can really feel the dip in quality when you're playing. There is a vibes shift at points that made me feel like something was off, and as soon as I found out about this while talking with friends and researching for the video, yep, it sure did explain everything. However, they did remove Haruki Quest, so there is merit to this version. This is real. This is in the original version, I see.
Look at him go! I feel like I should clarify this before I go any further, that I'm not stating any of this to say that Takeshi is a stinky loser baby who should be burned at the stake for his sins to the Edoge gods. If anything, it's the opposite. I've worked in game dev and I know how much it sucks shit to pull double duty because of office politics. I think ICA's scrunkliness is the reason why developers should be given as much time as they need to refine within reason, and why studios gotta have the freedom to hire people who can get the job done right in a pinch if they really need. Even worse, this issue carries into CC. Maybe the scope of the project ballooned during development, maybe Leaf was running low on time, or maybe Takeshi was just severely overworked and had to take much needed breaks, but Leaf ended up bringing in two additional artists to fill in gaps, and you can tell when Takeshi handed off illustrating duties as the art style abruptly changes, sometimes mid-scene. To be completely clear, the other two artists are not at all bad at their work. Masahide Yanagisawa and Kenichiro Katsura are both Sogna expats who cut their teeth illustrating for the Viper series on PC98, notable for their stunning pixel art animation and hilariously huge floppy discounts. These two have been in the industry for a long time and have brought some really solid art to the table. The Viper series is gorgeous, but unfortunately their styles just didn't mesh with Takeshi's here. There's also the matter of the character sprites. Some look wonderful and detailed, capturing all the wonder of Takeshi's original designs, while others feel like roughs that got colored in and finalized because they couldn't spare the budget for anything else. Maybe the most clear example of this is Setsuna sprites in Coda, which have some angles that look kinda weird. Maybe the most striking issue though is the sheer lack of CGs. For a game that takes at least 70 to 80 hours to clear, potentially and probably way more for many readers, moments with unique illustrations feel too few and far between. Not even in a way that amplifies their power when they do show up, there were just numerous scenes that felt so emotional and impactful, it got a little undercut by having to stare at fucking Gakuen Handsome. What truly baffles me though is how they seemed to know this was an issue and tried to compensate by adding a panning background to some scenes to create motion and intrigue. This would be fine, it is a common trick, it works very well. Except all of the backgrounds are stored at the game's base resolution, so the zooming creates artifacts. Acting, they stop scrolling abruptly so it feels like someone hits the brakes in the middle of your reading, and they generally go at a pace that does not match the dialogue present at all. Whether I was reading at a high or low or even just an average speed, it never felt right. To summarize, White Album 2's scripting is a mess, and a disappointing one at that given the quality of past Maruto works. I spent a very long time praising the staging and scripting work in my Parfait video for good reason. It's because that game really exemplifies just what you can do with visual novels as a medium purely on a visual level. Text scroll speeds, font sizes, sprite movements, it was a game full of a ton of tricks that made it feel alive, almost anime-like, and really showcased the warmth of Maruto's writing. And to give credit, all that stuff is here to some extent, but not to any extent that feels more than purely sub-average. The fact that even Leaf's own 2004 remake of a 1996 game, Shizuku, feels more lively is honestly sad. Like, this is still an incredible story, if not just on the writing, but it's missing all the polish that would make it a perfect 10, including in the sound department. Before we go to the own zone again, I want to focus on the positives. First, White Album 2's voice acting is goddamn incredible, and unlike most of the games I cover, it's actually got VAs who rightfully got to have good careers both before and after the game. Madoko Yonezawa from K-On! And Grand Blue as Setsuna, Hitomi Nabatame from Fate and Garupan as Kazusa, Takuma Tadashima from Mikaku City Actors and Log Horizon as Takaya. You can seriously pick almost anyone from the cast and find roles in media that range from kinda notable all the way to incredibly beloved. And expectedly, all of them do an incredible job. I cannot think of a single time playing the game where I considered for even a second that it felt like I was listening to someone play a role rather than an actual person speaking. Every line from the most solemn and quiet to the most brazen and aggressive feels packed with honest emotion. Every line from the most casual to the most serious feels like it was given equal care and respect. And every single moment of the game is elevated by the constant presence of the VA. Hell, they even went as far as casting a voice actor for Haruki, one of the rare examples of a full voice male protagonist in VNs, and goddamn does he moan cute. Some of the VAs also pulled double duty as singers, notably Maruko performing 9 insert songs across all 3 chapters of the story. And those songs, along with all the other vocal performances in the game provided by the other VAs, are really some of the highlights of the whole experience, beautifully integrated into the story of the game to bestow plenty of added meaning onto them while still being wonderful pieces on their own. My personal favorite, and I think the first I ever heard from the game, has to be Toki no Maho or The Magic of Time, which is also a major spoiler in terms of placement and lyrics. But suffice to say, I was incredibly fond of
all the vocal performances in the soundtrack. Even the covers of music from White Album 1 I felt far surpassed the originals. Also, if you're a fan of other Leaf games, there are plenty of references to them just in the music alone. The themes from Roots and a couple other games make appearances here as songs. Of course, I can't talk about the vocals without mentioning the theme song of the game, Todokanai Koi, a title translating to An Unreaching Love. Canonically written by Haruki, the lyrics of the song are emblematic of the feelings of all three of the main characters, embodying their core struggles while also being an absolute bop in any of its many incarnations. This, however, brings me to the in-game soundtrack, which is fine in a vacuum. It's got a couple of standout tracks like Seiya and Kirei de Hakunai Mono, but most of it really exemplifies generic VN music. You have the sad piano track, the goofy slapstick track, the casual talking track, the walking around track. It's all very played out and familiar without much individual identity. And though I don't mind that in and of itself, even if it is funny, a game with music as a core plot point doesn't have much interesting music, the problem comes with the sheer lack of it. If there is anything that almost everyone who's played White Album 2 and written a review seems to be able to agree upon, it's that the game seriously lacks variety in background music. From the moment you start introductory chapter to the moment you finish Coda, you will be hearing the same tracks over and over and over again, to the point where you can start to predict what's going to play and where based on the mood a scene is headed towards. I don't know if I'd ever say it lessened the emotional impact of any scenes, but it did become kind of grating at points to hear Sad Song 69 play for the 420th time. And even beyond that, it's apparent to trained ears that the game has been scored by multiple different artists, all using startlingly different equipment and styles. Five, in fact. There is a very strong disparity in instrument quality across different tracks, with some sounding like they were produced using then top-of-the-line virtual synthesizers for the era, and others sounding like they could have been in the original Two Heart. Which is fine, I love the 90s CD audio sound aesthetic and work if it for my side job as a game musician when I'm not doing chiptune, but there's this feeling I get listening to the score that there is a serious lack of coordination with the sound sets used. And the weirdest part about all this, it's not like it wasn't handled by a professional studio. Aqua Plus's very own studio Aqua managed the soundtrack, with Leaf veteran Nayo Shimakawa being put in charge of supervising the in-game audio, who for the record did a fantastic job at creating a cohesive soundscape for Teninai, Roots, Shizuku Renewal, and many other titles, so I don't know what in God's name happened here. It doesn't end at the music either, as the rest of the audio is scuffed in ways, such as with the sound effects. Most were fine, but others felt bizarrely mixed and like they seemed to have some weird phase inversion applied, so they just sound like they're coming behind you if you're playing on headphones. And though the actual voice acting is amazing, I noticed a number of mishaps involving poor audio balancing, horribly concealed retakes, and a lack of consideration for loudness compensation. Like, there's a number of voice lines that are played through a school radio and have fitting filters applied, which boosts the high end, which the human hearing is more sensitive to, but the engineering didn't compensate for this, so there's a couple segments where it felt like my friggin' ears were getting blown out. Or you have sort of the opposite, where some segments have voice acting that feels like it was made too quiet, so the BGM suddenly just becomes loud in comparison. At the end of it all, it's clear that White Album 2's production was a bit of a mismanaged mess, though how much so I haven't been able to ascertain. There's one or two interviews that I was able to find that featured Takashi, but he doesn't at all go into the production history. And everything of Marito is focused on the writing and characters as opposed to the rest of the development. And I guess that's fair, as it is really what carries this game. Despite all my grievances with the presentation, Marito did such an incredible job pulling the whole story together that I'd still go as far as to call it one of the most meaningful experiences I've had. And I know I say that a lot on this channel because I keep stumbling into fantastic games, but seriously, White Album 2 is well worth every bit of hype it's gotten, and in order to demonstrate that, I am finally going to be getting into spoiler territory. I'll be diving into my thoughts on each individual route, the themes of the game overall, and everything that entails. So if you don't want to get spoiled, then I would suggest skipping ahead to the concluding segment of the video where I wrap up my thoughts and give my final verdict. But before that, I would like to take a moment to thank all the patrons and other donors who make content like this possible, and shout out some cool people that you should check out. Greetings everybody, and welcome to the Patreon segment, that part of the video in which I give life updates, channel updates, shoutouts, and appreciate all the folks and folkettes and folkenbies who make this possible. For the first of those, well, there isn't too much to say, I guess, but also there is. I'm back in the US for another month or so before I fly out and stay in Brazil for a chunk of the year. I'm busy dealing with prep for that, and also busy with actual moving prep to go live in an apartment on my own when I come back to the US. And probably not the best decision on my part to write a 2.5 hour video while so busy with that, but hey, life be what it do. All I can say for now is that I appreciate everybody's continued support, which makes it possible for me to focus on this content as my job and aim towards living somewhere better for me. We almost broke the 2K barrier this month and have fallen a little short again, but that's okay. The fact we're even close to it continues to blow me away. You're all seriously incredibly generous and kind people, and like, I don't know, it's like, it gets hard to like verbalize, right? Without feeling like I'm being dishonest about it because I just keep saying it, and I don't want to sound like I'm saying this out of obligation, but seriously, thank you all so much. It means so goddamn much to me.
And as is tradition for these segments now, I want to take a moment to give back to the community that makes this possible and shout out some cool creators who deserve way more love than they've gotten. And if you would like a chance to be shouted out here, whether you do art or music or games or videos or whatever, then send me a tweet on Twitter or a message on Tumblr. I am always looking for more cool people to boost. The first I'd like to shout out is Pause and Select, who makes videos talking about Japanese media and culture. While they have a lot of fantastic videos, the one that gripped me specifically was their video on the media mix, which might just be the best explanation of an extremely important concept of Japanese media that I've seen. With the help of a published author, it catalogs how the media mix came to be, series that define and defy it, and the context surrounding it, all with some incredibly stunning editing work that I am really jealous of. It is sharply put together, tightly written, and breezy to watch, as are the rest of their videos, which range in from 10 minutes to 2 hours. It's a channel I'm absolutely going to be binging over the next while, and if you like what I do, well, you're probably the exact audience for them too, so go check them out, give them a sub, and maybe donate their Patreon too. The second I want to shout out is Sean Shonson, who you might have seen around as a few of his videos hit it big, but most of them get even fewer views than mine. His channel almost entirely focuses on games for the original PlayStation, from heavy hitters to forgotten gems, often covered in hour plus long videos that discuss multiple games. What I love the most on his channel are his videos going to Japan-only PS1 games, suggested by viewers and dug up by him and chosen by random for each volume. Not only are they a fun way to learn about a ton of games you might enjoy, but they exemplify why I love his videos. There is a sense of honest respect for the media he discusses. As someone who is far too used to commentators dunking on Japanese media because it's weird or perverted or whatever, or making fun of old games just for laughs, seeing someone pick up even the most obscure and budgety of PS1 games and finding something nice in it feels like a breath of fresh air. I really can't recommend their work enough for that reason. Whether it's goofy, forgotten, untranslated jink, or well-known polished diamonds, his videos are always honest, fun, and a blast to check out. And with those channels hopefully propped up and other tabs to check out, I'd like to take a moment to answer some Patreon Q&As, so iku yo! Yurika Saki asks, what's your thought on the news about the official FSN English translation? Are there any untranslated white whale VNs giving you hope to see hit the English market as well? I mean, for the first one, thank god we don't have to use the Mirror Moon TL anymore. And for the second one, honestly, if Fate can somehow get an official English release, then, I mean, it's topical, but I'd love to see White Album 2 get one. Lily Scoot asks, would you ever consider covering Totono? Absolutely, it's one I've been curious about for a while, I just gotta find the motivation and space to talk about it. It's me, Mario, in the year 2002 I saw a deer stand up on its hind legs and scream like a human, Mamma Mia, asks, how long have you been learning Japanese? I've been interested in doing so, but I'm paralyzed by choice. My recommendation is to start with watching Cure Dolly's grammar videos and learning the two kanas, and then once you got through the basics, start watching anime and reading manga aimed at a younger audience while keeping up grammar studies. Once you feel like you decently get those, start reading visual novels. You can also just jump straight into media you're interested in when you have a basic foundation of grammar, but it is easier to start with media that already has a lower language level. Delta Wada asks, a potentially silly question, but do you remember having any gender envy from various Toho characters? Why you gotta call me out like that? Anyways, yeah, I had huge gender envy from Sakuya and Marisa when I was younger. I still want to do a cosplay of them both. Okay, with all that covered, I think it's now about time to wrap up this segment. As per usual, I want to thank everyone who donates to make this content possible, and if you'd like to have your name scrolling along with all these cool people, then consider donating monthly via Patreon or Ko-fi, or one time via the latter. In exchange, you'll get uncut video access, early video access, access to the list of games to cover, suggest games to cover, get status updates, ability to ask me questions, and sometimes other neato stuff. The minimum is $1, there's no tier gating, and there'll never be full videos locked behind that paywall. Your support is just for the fuzzy feeling and some neat little bonuses. These videos are most of how I make a do, so any support, from the smallest to the biggest donations, are greatly appreciated, and go straight to funding video and life expenses for me. But if you can't or don't want to donate, that's alright too. All support, from views to comments to subs to shares to donations, are important in making this possible, and I wouldn't be able to do this if it weren't for all of you together. As I enter new stages of my life and look towards making very big decisions, all that support means more to me than ever. Over the last 2 years I've been running this channel, I've moved multiple times, grown a ton as a person, and I'm now aiming to finally live by myself before eventually making my home in another country within a few years' time. I am happier than I've ever been, pushing towards more security than I've ever had, and all while working a job that I love that seems to mean a ton to all of you. So seriously, no matter how you choose to provide support, thank you so much. I'm happy things have taken a positive turn for me over these last few years, and I'm happy I could make a difference for so many of you. That's really the main thing. Like, seriously, I keep getting comments about how my videos are more helpful than therapy, and like, man, that feels like a lot of responsibility, but I'm also really honored. It feels wild, but it's nice. Anywho, I have rambled for long enough. Thank you all again, and let's get back to the show. I'm gonna be upfront here, White Album 2 is a monolith of a game to attempt to analyze, and it's for that reason that this will be, by no means, a comprehensive analysis. I'm gonna skip over scenes, I'm gonna give incomplete summaries, and I'm going to ignore entire themes because, as I'm wont to do on this channel, I want to focus on what resonated with me and stood out to me the most. Art is something personal, and if I tried to make something complete, I'd inevitably start rambling about things that didn't mean a lot to me. And thankfully, the sheer size of White Album 2 gives a lot to go over. With three separate but highly interlinked chapters, there's a myriad of places one could start, but for this, I want to begin with where the game begins. Not just because that kind of makes logical sense, but because a core theme of the game is the way everything yet nothing changes over the course of its free act structure until people actually take agency and push forward. At its core, the drama never stops being about the feelings that Haruki, Setsuna, and Kasusa all hold for each other and how that leads them to fuck up various parts of their lives. How the game avoids running that into the ground, however, is entirely through the ways in which they develop while holding onto those emotions. Because though they are all flawed and troubled from the start, none of them are even half as bad in IC as they are in CC and Coda. Haruki, for instance, isn't the dodgy coward bound up in emotions we see later, but an actually responsible person. Maybe too much so. One of the first things we see him doing is pulling triple duty in the school, studying as per usual, managing festival affairs beyond what he's assigned to do, and attempting to put the light music club back together following its fracturing, all with barely enough time to himself to sit down and relax. He presents a very head-on attitude for something like the first two thirds, even working himself half to death to train his guitar skills in preparation for the school festival. What eventually breaks this, so to speak, is what happens between him, Kasusa, and Setsuna. While the three initially start as friends, bonded together by a shared love for the song White Album, Kasusa quickly begins to grow more affectionate towards Haruki over the duration of the chapter, even if she fails to show it, and Setsuna does some very questionable things in response to this. That split in Setsuna's character I described earlier, between how she actually appears and who she actually is established very early in IC. Her outward appearance is that of a perfect woman by societal standards, an appearance so strong that it codes how everyone sees her throughout the game and stands in odds with what her life actually is like. She's a very, very lonely person who doesn't have anyone in her life besides her heteronormative nuclear family, whose appearance of perfection slowly starts to chip away as we're exposed to them throughout the game. Most strikingly, even into her 20s, Setsuna is still treated like a child, given a curfew, being called by phone regularly, and only given freedom when she's married off to a man her father approves of for taking care of her. It's a painful existence, made even worse by her appearance as a school idol. Not only has she been apprehensive to make friends for a long time after a traumatic experience in middle school that led to everyone abandoning her over petty drama, effectively breaking her, but now everyone sees her as this perfect, unreachable girl. Even Haruki's friends believe this and are shocked when they learn he's talking to her. The only reason Haruki is able to buck this isolatory trend is by a chance encounter when he's walking back from school and meets her as she works her part-time job, freed of the facade of a perfect idol and able to open up to him as an actual person. And being as oddly charismatic as ever, he manages to capture her attention and go out for karaoke with her, where we learn that no one really wants to invite her because she tends to dominate the nights all for herself. It's cute and quirky, but also emblematic of her whole personality being very self-centered without thinking much about it. Though it's rare for anyone to break past her exterior, if they happen to, she latches on strongly and does everything in her power to make sure those people don't leave her, which is what leads to all the drama in this game. While she at first only bonds to Haruki, she ends up becoming close with Kasusa as well when they, for the real superpower of teamwork, get her to enter in the light music club and both find her to be an endearingly brash person with a heart of gold. And thus, for the next while, Setsuna has again found what was once lost and seems to be living in a period of pure joy for just a moment. The three practicing together to play two songs from White Album for the school festival, as well as a brand new one, Todo Kanai Koi. Where it begins tumbling down is after the school festival with the confession. Setsuna admits her love to Haruki in a dimly lit room, but not wholly out of a genuine affection for him. Mixed in there is that fear of abandonment, worrying if Kasusa and him were to get together, she could be tossed aside. And though she states this intention very clearly to Haruki at the end of IC, it feels a lot more tragic when you actually see it develop in real time. One of the most interesting tricks the game pulls is the addition of new scenes upon clearing Chiaki's normal ending in CC, including one which shows Io telling Setsuna that she should act quick if she wants to be of Haruki. Though she initially seems to be not too terribly worried, her fear of abandonment is triggered when she sees Kasusa kissing Haruki as he drifts asleep to the tsundere's piano playing, leading Setsuna to impulsively confess to him. Haruki and Kasusa shared an ability to confess their emotions to each other earlier, and Setsuna's trauma turned lack of faith in people to stay by her side collide into a whirlwind of emotions that all of them are forced to navigate. And that collision is the beginning of Haruki going from someone who bears an absurd sense of responsibility for everything in their life into someone who dodges their emotions and hides them, refuses to let other people be involved in his life. Initially, things seem to be going great when they're all unaware of what's brewing beneath
beneath the surface. Kazusa gives her slightly distraught blessing to the two's relationship, her and Haruki keep whatever emotions they may have for each other in check, and the three even go together to a trip on a hot spring, vowing again to stay together forever. But that promise crumbles when Kazusa gets a sudden phone call. Following her return from the hot spring and Kazusa landing fifth place in a music school entry concert, her mother confirms she's made arrangements for her to pursue her career in Vienna. Established in another hidden scene as an offer made, at least in part, to give her a chance to escape her emotions for Haruki. No matter how much Setsuna or Haruki plea, she is dead set on her decision, even missing Setsuna's birthday party to make preparations to leave. And likewise, Haruki finds his heart dead set on being with Kazusa, also missing Setsuna's celebration in order to catch up to Kazusa, confess, and begin their affair with a messy, mutual explosion of emotions. That more or less sets the status quo for which the rest of IC plays out with. Haruki attempts to hide these feelings for Kazusa from Setsuna even as they escalate to taking each other's virginity on a whim, and Setsuna acts as if she's wholly unaware of what's going on until the confession on the way to Kazusa's departing airport that she knew of Haruki's love for her all along. She just wanted to avoid losing anyone, and ironically, as shown as the two kiss in the airport, lost everything by giving into her fears. It's a depressing, sad tragedy, and one the player is made aware of from the very beginning through the last scene of Setsuna and Haruki alone on the rooftop lamenting Kazusa's leaving, being the first one you see in medias res style. In addition to that feeling of powerlessness that Maruto talked about wanting to capture, it creates a feeling of inevitability as well, which is later subverted in Coda. The consequences of living in a society trademark are a major theme of White Album 2, manifesting most prominently in how the expectations of it shape our main characters. Where that comes into play in IC is how the love that the free want to share is inherently counter to the framework which societies exist under, and the one Setsuna believes it must exist under. While she claims to be fine with the three of them being together as a group at different points, she also very directly states at multiple points that she can't bear the idea of Haruki loving someone more than her, or even really another person at all. She wants everyone to stay together, but most definitely not in a polygamous sense, because that's not a thing which really seems to exist to her. There's a scene in IC where this manifests in a way that's kind of funny on its surface, but gets sadder the more you read into it. Alone on the rooftop, Setsuna cries in the Kazusa's chest, letting all of her feelings about her and Haruki out, before saying that she wishes Kazusa had been born a man, because she's come to love both of them. And like, when I first read this scene, I kind of chuckled, because the whole idea of, if only you were a man, feels so cliche, right? Like, in what world does someone just not realize you can be gay? And the more I thought about it, the more it hit me this scene really embodies just how isolated Setsuna has been. For one, it's impossible for her to consider that love can exist for more than one person. By pressures of society to be a pure, perfect lady, one woman can only ever be if a single man. And secondly, she's grown up in environments that have isolated her from anything but cishet conceptions of love. Though Setsuna definitely has this the worst, it's not as if the other two had nice upbringings either. Haruki had practically no relationship to his parents and has spent his entire life either in work or in school, and Kazusa's mother is a serial monogamist who skips from man to man and left her to be raised by maids in the school system. She's also the only one who seems to have any awareness that such an upbringing might have actually hurt her. At the very least, she holds resentment for her mother until they patch things up throughout CC and Coda, and laments her existence in a secluded world. The other two don't even get that. No one really inquires into Haruki's past, instead taking him at face value as a strong independent man, despite the fact that he's an emotional wreck deep down. And because the nuclear family unit is such a pervasive concept, anything toxic about Setsuna's family seems to get swept under the rug, despite the fact that you can easily trace a lot of her traits back to the isolation and infantilization her family has done to her. While I get people's urges to look at IC and the drama in WA2 as a whole and ask why everyone doesn't just form a polycule, because I also thought that because Setsuna sort of seems to suggest it, but not really, the isolation they've all experienced is exactly why it couldn't work out. All of them have been forced to live in environments that hide anything greater from them, and their traumas are so ingrained and excused by society that they don't even seem to realize how badly it's affecting them. Once again, Setsuna embodies this the most. She's a deeply flawed and broken person who admits in her ending to having no clue why she acts the way she does. After all, she's supposed to be the perfect good girl, right? So why would a perfect good girl act so cruel to others? Why can't she match up to her school idol image, her destined housewife image? Why does God give his prettiest princesses the worst personality disorders? Because of this, Setsuna finds herself unequipped to deal with her feelings and copes with them in one of the most unhealthy ways possible, indulgence. In response to what happened in middle school, she opted to keep most people at a distance, and when she did finally make new close friends, two people she seems to have equally fallen in love with, she chose actions purely for her own benefit, knowing they were going to hurt others and herself, completely unaware of better outcomes that could have fixed a lot, and that those actions do cause harm, as reflected in Haruki's internal monologue. His thoughts at the start of the relationship seem earnest in a very awkward teenager type of way, but they quickly begin to read more and more like someone convincing themselves that they like the relationship they're in. Any doubt cast on his love stings him and crosses that fragile line between the comfortable lie of affection and the reality of who he truly loves, embodied in his discomfort when Takeya and Io both ask him whether or not he sees a future between the two of them. Haruki never seems able to be honest about the answer to that question, even though it's blindingly clear to readers through his internal monologue. He wants to be with Kasusa, but rather than pursue that and be honest with Setsuna, he stays in a relationship that society sees as able to be perfect. I'll talk more about this later, but this comes back in both Sisi and Koda with how Takeya and Io see Haruki and Setsuna as a couple. Anything that's wrong is blamed on Haruki because Setsuna is perfect. A superficial examination that ignores they are both fucked up people hurting each other who probably need to break up. But because of an overbearing expectation of unwavering dedication and heterosexual love to the point of willful ignorance over others' flaws, that is not considered a possibility. But lacking self-awareness is exactly why a poly thing could never work out. Just as I discussed queer people being prone to recreating the shittiest parts of cishet culture by virtue of being raised in it in my Monokashi video, people in polygamous relationships are prone to recreating the worst parts of monogamous relationships by virtue of society treating those as a default. A relationship between three unhealthy people is no more invulnerable to damage than a relationship between two unhealthy people. It just adds more room for jealousy and conflicts to arise. In order for people to be good for others, they first have to be willing to improve themselves, something which each of the good endings that come in CC and Coda explore. But what we have now in IC, after all is said and done, is three people broken for the worse. Haruki goes from an overly dependable, overly responsible, bright-eyed boy into a depressed wreck who blames himself for everything while absolving all others of their much-deserved guilt. Torn between pursuing the one he loves most and staying with someone who gives the appearance of being perfect, practically everyone in his life pushes him towards the latter, even when the relationship is not working out for them. Setsuna reverts back to how she was after losing her first friend group, but even worse. She blames herself for everything that went wrong and will continue to go wrong and sees any sort of pain she experiences as a form of retribution for being a bad girl. Haruki cheating on her is seen to her as acceptable because she committed the sin of stealing him away from Kazusa. Haruki effectively ignoring her for most of CC is acceptable because she expresses numerous cruel emotions towards him when they are around each other. And Kazusa loses whatever kind of emotional honesty and openness she gained from being with the two, which isn't much, but going from someone who threw punches at others for trying to enter her personal space to actually saying what she thought, at least in a volatile way, was some form of progress that all vanished as she escaped to Vienna, going as far as to block communication with them entirely. This is the emotional stalemate the characters find themselves in when they come in the closing chapter. With Kazusa gone from their lives for 3 years now, Haruki and Setsuna, graduated from high school, are dating only in name. Him more or less ignoring her and treating her as an unrelated person, and her refusing to let go as she desperately clings onto whatever semblance of love once existed to avoid losing yet another person in her life. Being this is college, however, things have at least started to change for Haruki. Though Setsuna finds herself drifting aimlessly through life, Haruki's got himself juggling studies and two part-time jobs, one in a family restaurant and one of the magazine company, leading him to make acquaintances with the side heroines mentioned prior, who all act as major players in the plot regardless of the route chosen. Because of them, Haruki ends up with three different abstract things influencing his life that all lead him down the road of attempting reconciliation with Setsuna. For Koharu, it's an incident involving him and her friend Mihoko she takes overbearing responsibility for and Haruki ends up tied up in. For Mari, it's him being assigned a job to gather information and write a story about Kazusa for a magazine feature. And for Chiaki, the most avant-garde of the character, she works behind the scenes to manipulate characters and learn about Haruki and Setsuna's past. Where these three paths coalesce before once again diverging is towards the very end. After Chiaki works behind the scenes to get Setsuna to be open about her emotions with Haruki, after Mari puts Haruki's endearingly scathing feature on Kazusa the print, and after Koharu does enough to convince Haruki that he needs to take some responsibility in his life, Takeya and Io hatch a successful plan to get Haruki to go on another date with Setsuna in hopes the two can patch things up. Fittingly, that date is planned to happen around Christmas, a holiday that couples are meant to spend making cherished memories. Initially, things seem to go decently well, as they get food while Haruki hands over a copy of the magazine he worked on to Setsuna, who claims she hadn't read it before, finding it both funny and nostalgic with how it's written in that same scolding reverence he always spoke to Kazusa with. She genuinely seems to like it, and after they leave the restaurant, under the cold embrace of the snow, they make a promise together to start over from scratch and to forget Kazusa for good. But that promise is immediately shattered. After they get into their hotel and Setsuna goes to shower, shower, Haruki reads the booklet again for one last time, accidentally leaving it out in the open when she leaves to give him his turn. And upon reading it again, like she had in reality countless times, she completely breaks, realizing that Haruki didn't forget the Kazusa and immediately went back to remembering her, and realizing that his feelings for her had never changed in all of these years and never will. The scolding reverence with which the future had been written is exactly how he spoke of her, and feeling incredible shame and guilt over his emotions, after Setsuna snaps and slaps him and yells at him, Haruki flees the scene to leave Setsuna alone in the hotel room, making his way towards the train station to decide where to go from here. It's a powerful point to break off into the heroine roots from, and one that establishes an interesting baseline for the game to work from. With Setsuna refusing to contact Haruki out of frustration and Haruki refusing to contact her out of shame, the two are back to a stalemate that leaves Haruki, in his mind anyways, free to pursue other options to try and mend the pain he's feeling. Because of this though, Setsuna basically doesn't matter to the rest of CC. She does appear in the first of the two normal endings, where Takeya again ropes Haruki into a goofy little get-together scheme that forces him to be a Setsuna, and obviously within her own route, but her appearances are otherwise relegated towards the end of each side route so Haruki can properly end things with her. That makes most of her character development happen in the background, but that doesn't mean she doesn't have any great scenes. She's just not the focus anymore, and that's fine, because Haruki has more possibilities in his life than just her. What I find most interesting about Koharu's route, and something that's emblematic of a trend in White Album 2's writing as a whole, is how strongly it plays into the idea that while no situation is the sole responsibility of one individual, people also don't bear an indefinite responsibility to others. There's a balance to it, and Koharu and Haruki represent opposite sides until they both realize they need to change. On one hand, Koharu resembles Haruki in IC, someone who refuses to let others assist with their issues, but almost habitually wedges themselves into other people's lives and desires to solve their problems on top of her own. If someone she's taken an interest in is struggling, then she insists on trying to help them even if they won't help themselves. This rock then meets a hard place with Haruki, as someone who also believes individuals must take responsibility for their actions, but hates himself too much to do so for his own problems or let others become involved in them. He doesn't want people to like or care about him, leading to a scene at the start of CC where he snaps at Mihoko, friend of Koharu and a tutee of his. She thought he was single after he gave a wishy-washy answer to being in a relationship or not at the start of their tutoring, and is told it's her mistake for thinking he was available when she confesses to him. Haruki's refusal to get others involved in his life leads him to refuse to explain anything about why he rejected her, and it starts off the whole chain of events that leads Koharu to get involved in his life. And though it's easy to be pissed at him for being so closed off that he hurts everyone around him and refuses to do anything that can help him, which is fair, I think just getting mad and labeling him a coward ignores the larger complexities at play. Like, let's not forget that Setsuna is an abusive, manipulative person who has been gaslit, gatekept, girlbossed by society into believing she has to be and is a perfect lady, never acknowledging anything is wrong with her except when she's in her lowest lows and gets called out. Let's also not forget that his friends encourage this outlook too, with few exceptions where Takeya is a bro and actually plays devil advocate for him. Having spent the last 3 years of his life being told what a piece of shit he is, with the only avenue presented to him by the people he knows being to pursue this relationship further despite his troubles, it does kinda make sense the only option he sees is running away, to leave it in a limbo which vaguely holds a piece together for him, Setsuna, and his friends, while hurting others like Mihoko and Koharu. Koharu desperately wants to help Haruki with this and spends the entirety of the common route yelling in his ear that he needs to man up and speak with Setsuna, rather than dragging things out. She only subsides on this one during her route. Haruki opens up enough to explain everything that happened between the two of them, including the night at the hotel. All of that leads her to completely switch sides, putting all of the blame on Setsuna and seeing Haruki as a victim caught up in her flaws. After all, he attempted to give her a chance to reconcile with him and lashed out instead at the first mistake, so what does he owe her? It's a complete 180 which not only absolves her of any worry over what Setsuna thinks, but leads Haruki to see her as the singular ally in a world that's otherwise denied his side of the story. Even after clearing worries over Setsuna from her mind though, Koharu is still preoccupied with trying to fix things elsewhere with Mihoko, and ironically rejecting any help from Akko and Sayori, their mutual longtime friends, despite herself being someone who tries to interject into others' troubles, which proves to be the exact thing that leads to her losing her friendship with all of them. One night, when she and Haruki are out late together after a shift at work, they sit together on the park bench to talk, and Mihoko spies them from above. Immediately, she believes them to be a couple and wonders just why Haruki rejected her. Though Koharu tries to smooth things over some days later, she ends up making the same mistakes that Haruki did, hiding countless details over her and Haruki's relationships from Mihoko, and still refusing to give any sort of clarity as to why she was rejected by Haruki when he could clearly get together with someone. Like, they are together, right? Not at this point, and certainly not until the route ends, but Koharu can't bring herself to speak honestly about her growing, vague closeness of Haruki. And because of that, and her refusal to accept any outside help, she ends up destroying her relationship with Miyoko, putting her in a stalemate that winds up with her confiding in tears to Haruki and kissing him the same night. From here, the bizarre dynamic the two have continues to escalate. They're not romantic partners, not openly anyways, as Haruki is still with Setsuna, but they're clearly more than just friends as they share their bodies with each other. But they aren't just friends with benefits either, because there is a romantic spark that's always there, yet it's never strong enough to light a fire. Rather than attempt to define any of this and create any sort of boundaries that might make it healthy, the only thing which occupies their minds during their time together is the comfort and the familiar warmth of another broken person. Two people who've hurt others around them by their dishonesty, two people who are running from themselves, and two people who are leading themselves down a path of destruction. Unlike Haruki, however, who seems content with escaping like this forever, Koharu has an overwhelming desire for something more that tears her apart. She wants to be his girlfriend, but she knows that if nothing changes between them, and if nothing changes between Haruki and Setsuna, then she's only ever going to be able to play the role of one for brief moments, relegated in reality to nothing more than a friend and a fling. Yet despite how much that hurts her, she keeps coming back to it just for those brief moments. There is a familiar yet discomforting stillness to it all. Two people embracing under roles vaguely defined enough for each of them to make what they want out of it in the moment, yet never solidified enough to mean anything. It's an uncomfortable, unnerving pairing. On one side is someone who's still in a relationship, yet one that's so poorly held together as to functionally not even exist. And on the other is someone who's desperate for some sort of human warmth and love as their lives fall apart, and just so happens to find someone who's gone through the same things. Unfortunately, that someone hasn't begun to reconcile it in a way that allows him to help her, only to further drive her down in a mutual spiral. And as someone who's been on both sides of those kinds of wishy-washy dynamics, I get it. If you're someone who's in an abusive relationship that seems like it won't end, one which results in you being hurt every time you try to disengage from it and every time you engage with it, it can seem easier to try and fill the void in your heart left behind with the temporary warmth of other people. That's how sex was for me for my teen years. With approval from my first partner one day and demonization the next, I sought online hookup after online hookup trying to feel desirable. Whether it was for brief moments or for months, exchanging vague words of love and explicit words of pleasure with people gave a reprieve that stayed in my mind as a single positive event. Neither preceded nor succeeded by abuse like the positive moments with my then partner had been. And yet, no matter how nice it felt in the moment, it always made guilt pile up. On top of feeling bad for potentially cheating, all of the shaming I'd heard towards sexually open people growing up made me feel even more worthless. I felt like nothing more than a whore, so if that's all I was ever gonna be, then why should I stop doing this? If people are just going to despise me, why shouldn't I at least have brief moments of happiness with others in the midst of it all? As deeply unhealthy as that mindset is, it is the one that I fell into, and one that I didn't escape until the relationship I was in finally ended, calling it quits after realizing it was never going to stop by the other's volition. That didn't make it any less painful to call off, though. I was depressed after it ended and even more desperate for affection, but that pain did eventually subside, and I was all the better for making that decision. Marito manages to capture this kind of nothing matters spiral shockingly well in this route, as Koharu digs herself deeper into this hole in response to her school life falling apart. While she definitely has it better in terms of social groups than, say, Setsuna, she's got a decent family, a friendly part-time job, and a student life, the last of those is still by far the most important. However, Hojo High is stated at multiple points to be a bit of a preppy school, reaffirmed in this route when Koharu describes her upbringing as being abnormal for it, coming from an average family that lives on the outskirts of town. Despite that, however, she still has friends in Mihoko, Sayori, and Ako, who all together form a tight-knit friend group. Because of that tightness, however, that Mihoko's depression spiral, spurred on by Koharu's dishonesty, becomes a way in which Koharu is ousted from the group, the final straw being Mihoko withdrawing her application to Hojo University. Adding on to that is the way the rest of the school reacts to her getting with Haruki. Being a school that holds itself up to a high moral standard, Koharu merely kissing Haruki, a man she's not even dating, is seen as dirty and uncouth behavior by her classmates when someone snitches on her, or if mocking and derisively calling her slut over, let alone her actually having sex with him, which she ends up playing into by getting hickeys all over her body to show everybody that she is, indeed, a slut like everybody says, out of self-hate. All of it combined, Haruki's awful guidance, her loss of friends, and her reputation taking a pummeling makes her question what the point even is in trying to do well in school and to mend her relationships when people can be so quick to turn. As well as that, it leads her to pursue that self-destructive relationship with Haruki, as she at least knows that he understands her, even as the toll of being just a fling weighs greater and greater on her. I think the sequence that best embodies this comes in the climax of The Root, where the harassment from other students reaches a peak, her being vandalized at the yearbooks and being, self-destructively, totally okay with it, and sees her isolation from society as an inevitable part of her existence. Hearing from others how severe her spiral has gotten, Haruki, after all this time, realizes he not only needs to take responsibility for how he's treated her, but to be somebody she can rely on, too. Not as a place to escape, but as an equal who is willing to help her like she wanted to help him in the beginning. And though she initially refuses, considering herself a slut who doesn't deserve kindness, let alone from a man who's already taken, let alone from the man who has caused her to spiral like this, Haruki pushes his way through and helps her to realize that she can still come back from the hole that she, Haruki, and those around her have dug her into. Through this, the two regain their sense of responsibility, but not in the form it had been before, where they took on everything themselves until they collapse. The two realize they need to pick each other up where they can't pick themselves up, Haruki helping Koharu to make amends with her friends and apologize to Miyoko with a letter to her mother, and Koharu helping Haruki to make amends with Setsuna, finally ending their forlorn relationship to pursue something greater with each other. Even Setsuna gets some character growth, as when Koharu talks with them after Haruki faces them himself, they recount their middle school story not as something which defines their life, something which has led them to an undefeatable fear of abandonment, but as a story to tell Koharu that life, no matter what, goes on. That even if you lose your friends, even if you lose your lover, even if you feel you have lost everything, life still goes on. It's a deeply touching moment, and one that I think embodies why this Root works so well right after I see. It shows that both Haruki and Setsuna actually succeeding to move on from their relationship in a way that's healthy for all involved, and is overall an acknowledgement that progress can always be made, but that progress is often a painful and unclear venture which is easy to lose sight of. After all, for much of The Root, what Koharu believes will move her forward in her friendship ends up backfiring. She loses the one she cares about the most, everyone she could have talked to turns against her, and the whole world seems as if it's going to go on without her. So why continue to put any effort into anything when there's no way forward? But what Haruki says in his climactic dialogue when he takes responsibility is that giving up because all seems lost is just throwing away everything you've worked for up to that point. Just because what she's known seems as if it's going to go away doesn't mean she has to quit everything. You can still pave your own road, even if you're uncertain where that road might lead you. Furthermore, The Root acknowledges that progress in and of itself isn't the responsibility of only an individual, and that can make things even more terrifying. People are social creatures, and we don't make decisions in a vacuum. Our choices are made based on a small collection of events that is life, and the broken human ways we attempt to make sense of them, creating great webs of lies and misfortune and emotional vial that everyone involved has to untangle. It is easy to get caught up in those and pin responsibility solely on one person, as Haruki and Setsuna do to each other. But as this ending shows, moving forward means accepting the hard fact that it is almost never a straightforward thing to untangle those webs. You have to do it, but it inevitably means facing up to the fact that your mistakes and the mistakes of others requires accepting that you'll maybe have lost things in your life that were once precious, as Haruki moved on from Setsuna and Koharu moved on from Miyoko. And yet, despite how painful it was, they still did it and they were all the better for it. A perfect crystallization of what I feel White Album 2's core theme is. Time is progress and progress is inevitable. No matter what you suffer, no matter what happens to you, your life is never going to come to an end. Even if you lose the one you love the most and the people around you, even if you fuck up greatly, there are always chances to rebuild and move forward, to forge new paths and new friendships, so long as you face society head on rather than run. And part of that means that accepting that your mistakes are often not only your own. If Koharu's Root is a perfect crystallization of an idea, then Mari's Root is like something going just kinda wrong during the chemical process. The end result is still nice, generally, but it's maybe a bit cloudy and smells a bit funny, probably worth trying again if you get the chance to do so. This being game development, however, what's out there in your final product is out there, so you just gotta cope with your funny smelly crystals. This is a horrible metaphor to say that while I do enjoy her Root overall, the taste it's left in my mouth has soured in the months since playing. It never contends with the messy questions it brings up about consent, nor with the core issue of workplace power imbalances, creating something that's not as perfected and meaningful as Koharu's, nor as meta-experimental as Chiaki's. To start, however, I want to commend what The Root gets right, such as its exploration of older women's fears of being unable to find love. Much of what fuels the drama that happens in this Root on Mari's end is her being so absorbed in her own feelings of undesirability, being a working, commanding woman in her late 20s, that she sees herself as unable to be desired by anyone. The good men her age are all gone and married, men younger than her are unreachable, work is time-consuming, and honestly, why doesn't she just fuck her also single single office lady friend. Why don't they have Yuri? They're such a cute couple. I have and have had friends who expressed all of these same things. Trying to find a relationship after your mid-20s is hard when you are a busy working person for all the reasons just outlined. One can hardly sacrifice time for their job, which keeps them afloat, in favor of spending more time at social engagements to meet people and find your plus one. This is not even to mention the stigmas which tell older women that they have less value than their more youthful counterparts. There's words for it in pretty much every single culture, though the ones I'm most familiar with are the 80s and Japanese slang of Christmas cake and the word urenokori, which literally means unsold goods. Normally, I wouldn't say those kind of things outright because of their offensive connotations, but it's important here because Mari, having lived in those years, absorbed that exact kind of language and rhetoric, now believing herself to be exactly those things. She sees herself as incapable of being loved and resorts to work as an escape, seeing it as the one thing that can never betray her or demean her. It's an unhealthy way to live life, but for her, someone who's past the prime school years of making friends, told she's past the prime of her love life, and someone who needs to work to survive, it's the only way she knows how to live. And even if I can't exactly relate to the age thing as a 23-year-old trans woman who keeps getting mistaken for 5 years younger than she actually is by strangers and liquor store clerks, I can definitely relate to her feelings of hopelessness and lost years. Like I've said on this channel, I grew up homeschooled, and one of the things that people always seem to forget about what that implies is that it means I didn't go to the main institution in which childhood friends are made in the US. I also wasn't homeschooled in an explicitly religious way either, so I didn't meet any friends at Bible camps or sterilized co-ops either. I was effectively stuck in a bedroom for 19 years with no one to talk to who wasn't online, hundreds if not thousands of miles away. Having unceremoniously dropped myself into the world at age 20, that lack of socialization made it hard still to find any sort of friends. I don't think it was until last year that I can say I actually found a group of friends who I fit in with perfectly, people that I can legitimately be myself around and not have to worry if some part of me is going to result in me being ejected. Because frankly, up to that point, most of my experiences with friends, by proxy including my family, were hanging around people and then either getting horribly abused or rejected for having an unacceptable hobby. I am unspeakably grateful for the group that I hold dearest to my heart and for the luck of many of them being decently near where I reside in the US, as well as for the few other more small to medium-sized online social spaces which I've managed to fit into well, because I don't think I would really have anyone otherwise. Even though many countries have it much, much better with people who actually want to talk to you and have conversation and be kind, like Brazil, love you Brazil, the US is one where being past your early 20s without any friends is more or less a recipe for playing the game of human connection on hard mode. And to my understanding, Japan is much the same way. People are kind and friendly outwardly, sure, but I've heard from both foreigner and native friends living there that trying to socialize past a certain age is really fucking hard. I think Mari's route does a fantastic job at showing how that creates almost a vicious cycle. Because it's hard to make friends, one ends up spending more time in their job to fill the void. Because one is spending more time on their job, they have less time to make friends. Because they have less time to make friends, they have less friends, so they spend more time on their job, and on and on and on. Hell, Mari is lucky that she even seems to have friends in her coworkers. I know a lot of people don't even have that. It's a trap that I found myself falling into with my very unhealthy tendency to work weekends and 10-hour days until my boyfriend forcibly pulls me into the warm grass of my bed to hang out and relax, and one which this route explores to its fullest consequences, not just from Mari, but Haruki as well, who's shown to burden himself with excess work, just like an IC, in order to escape his life. At one point early on in the route, Mari has gone on a business trip, and Haruki, in order to cope with his fresh emotional pains regarding Setsuna, works himself half to death, even skipping out on seeing a piano concert hosted by Kazusa's mother, ironically leading him to just barely miss the person he loves most in her first venture to Japan in years. But after arriving back from her trip, Mari promptly chews out the entire office for allowing Haruki to treat himself this poorly, and forcibly takes him back to her place in order to lock him in there so he sleeps. It's that extremeness which Mari is willing to go in order to make sure someone doesn't make the same mistakes as her that I find most interesting in her character. She is a deeply hypocritical person in a very adult way, knowing her exact failings and her exact problems and her exact false coping mechanisms, and trying to advise others not to do the same where possible, yet still actively indulging in them herself. With that, everything she's internalized about her age and her being a working class woman in mind, Mari doesn't exactly have a high self-image of herself, manifesting in a number of ways. Most notably, she's prone to pretty intense fits of rage, going as far as to smash up her own apartment when Haruki bails on a time he promised to meet her at. Which, admittedly, was mostly Setsuna's fault for putting off a planned meeting with Haruki and refusing to let him get to his core point of, can we break up please? I have a cute OL to be with. Beyond even that though, she's a very self-destructive person. Like, she knew before they even had feelings for each other that she was going to have to leave for Japan soon to live in the US for work, yet engaged with him anyways. And rather than tell him of this early on so they could have tried to figure out what to do, she just accepted it as a lost cause to enjoy the fleeting moments they could and did have. After all, someone like her will never find long-term love anymore anyways, right?
For one, this makes interesting parallels and connections between the two, as they are both people who escape into each other, neither of them realizing just to what extent the other is doing it. However, secondly, Mari's behavior in particular is an uncanny mirror at the Kazusa at the end of IC, where she asks to embrace Haruki for just a short time before escaping her relationship woes to Vienna, rather than trying to solve anything. However, this time, Haruki actually takes this chance for genuine character growth, with the rather heartwarming ending of the route seeing Haruki letting go of Setsuna and buying a plane ticket to be with Mari, knowing she's the one he loves most. As someone who has made their own short-term international journey to be with the person they love and has every intention and means to commit fully to sealing the deal on that long term, I think is a nice ending. It shows some fantastic character development for Haruki as he works up the courage to let his former partner down and pursue something greater, and gives genuinely promising prospects for the two to have a healthy, balanced relationship. It seems as if she's gonna try and adopt much healthier work habits, and Haruki, though uncertain what he's going to do, is at least totally okay being the one who maintains the home and looks after things so she doesn't have to. Which, on that note, I have to say this is one of the routes that proves he's a genuinely decent guy deep down. He's incredibly reassuring to Mari that she's lovable at her age, and very clearly has a deep, honest affection for her that's nice to see. But for as much as I like all of that, this route is still overall flawed. For one, I don't think the way it goes about adding on to the messaging of the game is all that interesting or unique. Chiaki's route is about how people can never truly put on masks, as well as the absurdity of dramas. Setsuna's route in Koda is about the ability for even the most damaged people to admit their faults and make progress. Kazusa's route in Koda is about learning to leave your past behind and embrace a beautiful, uncertain future. Koharu's route is about the importance of progress even when all seems lost and progress itself seems unknown. And Mari's route is basically just a watered-down version of Kazusa and Koharu's theming. Like, Haruki leaves Setsuna behind, but not really in a way that's as climactic or resonant as what happens in Kazusa's route in Koda, and Haruki decides on paving a path forward with Mari even if they don't know what might lay in store for them in another country, but it doesn't do nearly as much to establish just how frightening and complicated moving forward can be in Koharu's route, or hell, this is just similar to Kazusa's route, but again, not as interesting. I just can't help but shake the feeling as I write this script that what's here is just a worse version of what exists elsewhere. And normally I'm not someone who's like, oh man, game A does X worse than game B, burn it at the stake, but the problem here is compounded by the fact it fails to address any of its other core problems. To get the very obvious one out of the way first, Mari's position with Haruki is a clear exploitation of her position in the workplace. Am I questioning a spicy relationship in a game all about spicy relationships? Yes, but that's because the game itself is predicated on generally not letting bullshit go unchecked, whether that's directly through dialogue and prose or by engendering themes which question said bullshit. Like, I get it, a relationship with your hot commanding office lady boss who has a complex about her age might be hot in fantasy, but in reality, she is still your boss, and having a relationship beyond being friends at most, be it purely sexual or romantic or whatever, is going to create severe imbalances on both a corporate and interpersonal level. It's just not healthy. With that said, I also have to address the thing that almost everybody seems to get befuddled by in this route, and content warning, this is about sexual assault. One of the key moments of drama in the route involves Mari intending to leave Haruki alone in her apartment for a while so he can recover on his own from severely overworking, when he suddenly, as she's leaving, hugs her from behind and topples her, confessing his love and beginning to grind against her. What follows is her vaguely consenting to this, which isn't consent. She initially says no and tries to let Haruki down, but after his insistence says bewilderedly that anything except penetration would be okay, and after he finishes, he then realizes what he did could qualify as sexual assault and falls into a shame spiral about potentially having done a sex offense, even as Mari insists that she doesn't care. He completely ghosts Mari out of shame after this, believing himself to be too lowly of a person to be by her side, until eventually making plans to meet up with her, hanging out at a bar for a bit and coming back to her place, where she explains why she refused. One, she didn't want to risk pregnancy, as she sees her job as the most important part of her life and a child could ruin it. Two, she felt deeply subconscious because her hot friend she should just be fucking gay with told her that alcohol was affecting her skin. On one hand, it is interesting how Mari's apprehensions with sex mainly had to do with her feverish dedication to work. Again, she views that as so important that she's willing to sacrifice things that could fulfill her emotionally. That is relatable and interesting and only adds to the best theme of the route. Secondly, I do think the way Mari claims not to care about this at the time, presumably out of desperation for affection, is interesting, and she does later admit that she really wants to be loved. I myself have excused a lot of really horrible shit done to me at the time it happened, because it hit some niche in my brain that went, people are acknowledging me and want me, so that's good, right? It is a horrible mindset to have, but for someone who feels like attention from other people is a rarity, it's possible for really awful things to become proof that you exist and are wanted. And Mari is not shown to be above this sort of messiness and maladaptive coping, as demonstrated by her self-destructive tendencies. Had the route taken this angle and shown a mindset conflicted by being happy for attention and sad over being hurt, I think it could have been an interesting exploration of how victims excuse terrible things done to them. Problem is, though, Mari doesn't just claim to not care about this, she
genuinely doesn't. She's not viewed as a victim by the story because she wanted sex and only had a few holdups. She could care less that Haruki totally ignored her initial rejection of her, which is kind of fucked. Like, ignoring consent like that at all and going ahead with the act anyways should be a huge red flag. You can say no to sex that you want, and someone going along anyways with a yes they pushed out of you is abhorrent. It feels so out of place for Haruki too. He doesn't act anything like this for not just the rest of this route, but the rest of the game. He's impulsive, sure, but he's not impulsive enough to push a woman down and grind against her, which makes me wonder if this was even written by Maruto, given that the rest of the unit he works under did assist, and this also has practically no bearing on the story after a certain point. It's genuinely hard for me to believe he'd write something like this, but unfortunately, I don't have proof either way of such a claim. All I know is that, while interesting thanks to a couple of strong concepts and moments, Mari's route falls flat for failing to do anything new with the themes of White Album 2, instead rehashing ideas better tread elsewhere while adding a whole lot of messiness to them. It is not the season for office ladies in this game, I suppose. It is, however, the season of wannabe mastermind manipulators. Chiaki's route is by far the most bizarre, absurd, and experimental of anything within the game, and probably within Maruto's entire career from what I'm aware of. Rather than being just a soap opera romance drama of twists and turns, it instead places its attention on the inability of a story to ever capture a person in full, and the inability for a person to ever be truly, fully acting. She takes on the role of Haruki's silly classmate and friend during the entirety of Sisu's common route, as well as very sparsely appearing in some other character routes, busy doing seemingly nothing at points, and at others writing a story for one of her classes. That kind of carefree attitude carries on into her normal ending, where she ends up cohabiting with Haruki after Setsuna's Christmas meltdown, helping him recover for casual sex and forcing him to relax, before disappearing without a word. Haruki, made to move on in life without it effectively become his emotional crutch. However, you remember when I mentioned clearing her normal path unlocks additional scenes in IC? And remember how I mentioned she seems to have ties to Haruki's past? Well, in some of those unlocked scenes, we learn that she was in the audience of the high school concert and gained an interest in Haruki's life, believing there to be something fishy about the lyrics of Todoka Nai Koi and how he looked at the girls on stage with him. Though she never managed to meet him in those high school years, she held on to that interest for years, lasting all the way to and through closing chapter, wherein she's revealed to have been manipulating the stage of the story behind the scenes. Most notably, she meets with Setsuna multiple times, always under a fake name, in order to try and gather information on her and Haruki while pushing the two back together. Going through CC and IC again, with all these extra scenes added in, immediately makes one call into question just what it is she's actually doing in the story, as well as what's a genuine display of care and what's just acting. Is what she says about her past life to Haruki at one point, about a tenuous relationship to her parents, true? Is her affection for Haruki honest? Who even is she? It's a legitimately compelling plot thread propelled by additional scenes, which manages to take the soap opera drama of closing chapter's common route and turn it into a sort of mystery, making her route fascinating before it even begins proper, doubly so if the awkward cliffhanger that our normal route leaves off on. But ironically, it's her up and vanishing like that which leads Takeya and Io to become invested in trying to find this mysterious woman. Through a chain of events kicked off by them, which neatly enough includes a big love letter to Kizuwato in the form of a play, Haruki learns that she was a theater club student in Hojo High and tracks her down with the help of Takeya, which leads to one of the greatest scenes in the game as Haruki is invited to watch her explain all of her plans in excruciating detail on the stage. The answer to who Chiaki actually is that she is the star actor and writer for the Hojo University Theater Club. After the events of introductory chapter, she took a keen interest in the life of our main trio and made it her mission to attempt to write a play which would dramatize the events of their high school affairs, hoping to perform for an audience on the stage, the one place where she believes she can honestly express herself. In order to do this, however, she went to those extreme lengths to understand everything she could about Haruki and Setsuna, going under false identities and manipulating them for information, and ultimately culminating in those weeks over the new years. All of the casual sex, all of the friendship, all of the conversations with Setsuna, all of the everything was done only so she could better understand those two and turn their life into a story which could capture everything. Her only difficulty now is that she might have fallen in love along the way, but even she seems unsure of this. Enraged, Haruki pins her to the floor and threatens to punch her as he sobs, feeling horrendously betrayed as she looks on coldly and gives permission to hit her anywhere but the most important part of an actress, her face. And yet, despite his rage and despite his tears, he leaves her without a physical wound, only the face of a broken man seared into her memory. It is a fucking grueling scene to read. Chiaki recounts everything with the same tones she always speaks in. Smug at points, seductive at others, yet playful at some, wholly admitting that everything Haruki knew is a lie, while she herself seeming to not even be sure if that is a lie, as Haruki is forced to reflect on the fact that her playing masks and roles is not dissimilar to what he's done throughout the game. After all, how much of introductory chapter is spent with Haruki pretending to love Setsuna in front of her and others while struggling in his own room? How much of closing chapter does he spend pretending the two still hold a relationship while clearly not doing so and lying to whoever he falls in love with? Isn't his entire character until the very end of each path, at least in part, marked by his mental decline as he's unable to reconcile with emotions that he needs to reconcile with? For once, Haruki is put on the end of being deceived as opposed to being the deceiver. The difference between these two, however, is that Haruki does what he does because he's afraid to confront reality. He at least knows what he's feeling concretely, but he puts on masks and lies and pretend so he can live in a comfortable lie that will inevitably end. Chiaki, though, legitimately believes she doesn't know her own feelings. She sees herself as nothing more than an actress, someone who pretends to be other people to voice herself through, and through that, can never truly know herself. And yet, despite believing herself to have mastered that, she still can't actually capture other people in full, forced to realize this when her attempts to write Setsuna in the play come up short time and time again. When she thinks she finally has figured out what she needs to do to get her emotions, to have sex with Haruki and experience the same feverish highs that she had which hooked her, Chiaki is even more confounded when she's told the two never did that. Setsuna's emotions were born purely out of a few kisses, a few tender moments, and an obsession to never lose anyone again. A complicated mess of emotions that Chiaki cannot even begin to understand. This is solidified when Chiaki finally does perform her play, and the version of Setsuna she puts on for everyone is just ever so slightly wrong. All of her biases, her experiences, her preferences for writing, everything shows through in her recreation of the events of introductory chapter, which eventually ends in a new segment where her version of Setsuna confesses her love to Haruki. A moment that clearly reads not as her recreating Setsuna's actions, but desperately attempting to voice her emotions through her art and through another person. An act of emotional honesty and awareness concealed in the vessel of a mimicry. As someone whose entire career has essentially become voicing themselves through other people's creations and their representations of people for characters, there was something I found oddly reassuring about this final scene. I've spoken before about not knowing how real my emotions are just on the basis of much of my pains being tied up in abusive situations. But another aspect of that confusion is the fact that I don't often feel like I understand my feelings until I've run them through some sort of lens or filter. While I know that some people see me as an emotionally intelligent and wisely sage because of these videos, and if you do, please don't because I am a foolish baby girl, that in and of itself is almost a form of acting. Because outside of these videos, I am far from an emotionally mature and put together person. I am prone to instability, I withdraw, I self-harm, and I often find myself unable to do anything except just lay in bed while I contemplate what's wrong with me the second I am without a clear goal for the day. When I'm writing and voicing these videos, a lot of it feels like it goes away. Through the presence of a framework that gives me a clear set of boundaries to express specific emotions in, a stage to be on, I am able to hone in on my feelings and feel as if, even for just a brief flicker, like I actually know them. I think by relating to stories and interacting with them like I have, I've been able to make significant progress on myself that I wouldn't have otherwise. But inevitably, when all is said and done, when the script is finished and I finish pouring my heart out in a voiceover, that emotional immaturity and amnesia returns, and I sometimes feel as if I had gained nothing for a time. It gets to a point where I start to even doubt if what I write is even my feelings, or me simply and uncritically spitting back what I've read. If the stage is the only place in which I feel like I fully understand myself, then does that mean I'm just putting on masks to pretend I know emotions? Am I just lying to myself and everyone who listens to me? I know that truly isn't the case, but those are the kinds of questions I have bouncing around in my head, which makes actually finishing anything a struggle. Factual errors I can deal with in comments, omissions to discuss something I could always address in another video, but the core feeling that the emotions I'm expressing to everyone are just parts of a performance, genuine only in the moment I'm saying them and otherwise unknown to me, terrifies me to my core and makes me wonder if I'm even fit to do this job. What's the point of creative expression if all your feelings are lies, dreamt up by trauma-induced delusions of your own emotions, one that will vanish in a flicker the second your situation changes?
Why I find this route comforting, then, is that it states that nobody can ever truly put on a mask. While Chiaki believes that she can only genuinely express herself on the stage, the emotions she expresses on it aren't all that different from what she expresses off of it. All of the masks she puts on, all of her performances, resemble her offline persona in varying degrees. Her attempts to express herself through other people are her expressing herself through herself, because despite being an actress, she can never be anyone but herself. In that regard, Chiaki is wrong when she says she doesn't know her own emotions. Even if, when she's off the stage, they're nothing more than vague contradictory flickers, bouncing between a willingness to exploit the ones she loves and a feverish desire for them, they are born out of her genuine emotions. Even if, when she's on the stage, she exaggerates them for effect, there is an honest core with them, and I guess that kind of eases the worry I have in my head. Even if I have had issues in the past with exaggerating myself to have others to listen to me when I felt alone, even if I only feel like I have brief moments of clarity as I write and perform in the midst of overwhelming mood swings some days, those cloudy and overwhelming sensations are still my emotions as much as the well-thought-through ramblings I put into these videos. Because in the end, like Chiaki, my attempts to express myself through other people and through my art will never be anything but my expressions. Where we are left now then is with closing chapter's final route. It's by far the least thematically substantial, but still incredibly important in terms of structure. Setsuna's route is more or less a way for the story to segue into Koda and establish something that becomes important in it. Haruki and Setsuna's truly baffling ability to keep repeating the status quo without ever learning from their mistakes. In this, the two manage to make partial amends for what they've done to each other and return to old habits. Haruki once again picking up the guitar after having quit for years, and Setsuna finding her voice again through Haruki's playing, culminating in them performing an acoustic version of Torokanai Koi for the college festival before celebrating New Year's together with her family. Nothing actually gets fixed in this, though. The two apologize to each other, sure, and they make a promise to never spend more than a week apart from each other, but Haruki still harbors feelings for Kazusa deep down, and Setsuna still holds her same overbearing fear of abandonment that leads her to abuse and manipulate others when things seem dire, as well as being unable to accept that Haruki could ever have feelings for somebody else. As a result, the end of this route feels almost hollow. It's happy in the sense that everyone is together and finally celebrating a holiday with her, but it really drives home just how fake the kind of peace that Setsuna is searching for is. She wants to live in a perfectly normal monogamous relationship of pure love, the kind that proliferates romance narratives, but her inability to reconcile her cruelest emotions with her perfect princess persona is inevitably going to lead her to sabotage things again. With that lack of emotional maturity, all the two are capable of doing is idealizing and fetishizing a past that never existed and a future that never will. The two pick up music as a couple purely because they believe that returning to their high school hobby might light feelings that had been missing since then. Haruki seeming not to accept that he never had those strong feelings for Setsuna, and Setsuna living in the same illusion that he ever did. None of that is helped by how much people ship the two. As I've mentioned many times in the script, all of their friends and family seem Setsuna as this perfect housewife in training and Haruki as a dependable salaryman. They are, externally, by their own obsession with a perfect outward image, the ideal monogamous hetero couple. But as this route and the rest of the game will continue to show, the people who form those relationships are rarely the perfect people that society makes them out to be. Now, am I saying that people shouldn't be in those relationships? No, because that'd be stupid and also extremely hypocritical as someone who's literally dating a cis salaryman and wants to be a housewife. There's nothing wrong with wanting that kind of relationship, but there is something wrong with how society encourages people to pursue it without ever showing them other things exist, and believes this default to be so perfect, so healing, that there is never a need to question the contents of it, never a need to re-examine and rebuild in a way that works for the individual.
Sometimes straight culture seems so totalizing, so hegemonic, that it can blind its adherence to all other possibilities. Straightness shapes everything, precisely by narrowing the field of what is conceivable or limiting the imagination. This is one of the reasons why the late queer theorist José Esteban Muñoz defined queerness not as a sexual orientation per se, but as a utopian longing, a feeling of being pulled toward a queerer future, as yet unimagined.
This is a huge part of why, even in works that are not explicitly queer, I find myself thinking about what queer writers have to say regarding relationships broadly, as well as my own experiences within queer relationships. Because for all the difficulty I've had in these, certainly none of that has come from how being societally abnormal forced us to reevaluate just how societal status quo affect us and why they exist in the first place. People who don't exist out of that framework often don't get this liberty without others actively pushing them into it. Unfortunately for the cast, however,
However, White Album 2 does not have any cool butch biker lesbians to teach your characters about the importance of mental health and questioning what society wants out of you as a default, so Haruki and Setsuna are left to their own devices to sort things out. And somehow, the two manage to make things work for 2 whole years after this route. Until it all goes awry when Haruki is sent to Strasbourg in France to interview a client in December. Having worked his way up in the job he's been working since the start of Closing Chapter, he finds himself being given some major responsibilities, including this offer that work would not allow him to turn down, even though it means ditching on the 1 week promise he has with Setsuna for the first time in 2 years. The two do at least make some plans to try and amend this, Setsuna flying out to France of her own accord to meet with Haruki for the Christmas Mass, but this all turns out to be for naught when Haruki is informed by his boss just who this mystery client is, and catches sight of her seconds later, the world-famous pianist Kazu Satoma, battered and bruised from chasing after him on a whim. While she's initially insistent in interviews she conducts with Haruki that she will never return to Japan, her mother manages to convince her otherwise, as Haruki soon finds out upon his return from the trip gone awry. It ends with him not only missing Christmas Mass with Setsuna, breaking their promise, but being pleaded by Kazusa's mother, Yoko, to further pursue the job of Kazusa, believing him to be the only person who's ever been able to truly break through her shell. And thus, everything really begins again. Coda has to have one of the strongest introductions of any act in any visual novel that I've seen, and pretty fitting given that it is by far the best part of White Album 2. It takes all the drama and themes that have been running since the very beginning and fleshes them out with the three best routes it has to offer, giving both of our main heroines the bittersweet conclusions that they deserved. Maybe Kazusa more than Setsuna, but we'll get to that. Probably the most important theme of it though is the idea that we're doomed to repeat our mistakes if we never learn. Like I've said throughout this video, these characters are all severely het-brained, but they're both too deviated from society's overbearing desires to ever live comfortably within those demanding and demeaning structures, and too sheltered to know how to pick them apart and reassemble them into something which works for their lives. This is to say nothing of their inability to understand exactly what's wrong with themselves, something which immediately manifests in the Coda Common route as Haruki goes straight back to telling white lies to Kazusa and Setsuna decides to go no contact with Haruki, again, when he fesses up to spending time with Kazusa in Strasbourg. On a plus side for her though, she does end up scoring a job at a record label later and does look pretty damn slick in a suit. Because of this, Haruki ends up spending even more time than he otherwise would with Kazusa, eventually cohabiting in her new apartment, though continuing to text Setsuna the entire time to keep her up to date, even if she hardly replies. This is despite the fact that Haruki intends to get married to Setsuna in due time, and even directly proposes to her. That apartment also, conveniently, happens to be right next to his to make his still ongoing interview-turned-life journal job easier, something which Kazusa's mom did on purpose to bring the two closer. Which, yeah, I haven't really talked about Yoko much, have I? While she's present here and there in the latter parts of introductory chapter, just how much she tends to pull strings in Kazusa's life isn't clear until you have a full picture of the story. There's appended scenes in IC which show her actively offering Austria as a place for Kazusa to escape from her relationship to, there's scenes appended here in Coda after your first clear that show her pursuing her daughter to go to Japan to see Haruki in so few words, and then there's the whole buying an apartment right next to his thing. For better and for worse, she's shown to be a mother who has a very strong read on what her daughter wants, though how much that's out of trying to be a good mother for her for the sake of it, and how much that's trying to make up for her absentee parenting is something I'm not entirely sure of. She is a pretty shitty mom who basically ditched her kid to go be with a bunch of guys and pursue a celebrity career, which leads Kazusa to be outwardly resentful of her even in the best of times. The two genuinely do care about each other though, with her viewing Kazusa as the most precious thing in the world, even if she can't figure out how to do right by her, and Kazusa viewing her as one of her only true allies. It does a lot to explain why Kazusa not only has a very avoidant style of attachment despite her ability to love others deeply, but also why a sudden turn of events in the common route hits her so hard. Though she kept it secret from everyone, Yoko had been slowly developing leukemia, which is part of why she attempted to push Kazusa into returning to Japan, as if she were to die, she wanted to die in the country she called home, preferably with her daughter. But despite trying to keep this reasoning secret from her and only telling it to Haruki, it does eventually spill out after Haruki keeps going away from Kazusa without being wholly clear why, and the realization devastates her. Regardless of whether you choose Kazusa or Setsuna's true endings, this side plot inevitably comes up, and I think is one of the most emotionally moving in the whole game. Watching her attempt to come to grips with the seemingly inevitable loss of what she feels is one of the only allies in her world is heart-wrenching, as she does the exact thing she always does, retreats and hides from those around her. This makes, oddly enough, kind of a great segue into Setsuna's true ending, as her reaction to those events is very emblematic of the complexities of her character, which the ending seeks to explore. Her involvement with Kazusa and Yoko's struggles is started when Haruki, realizing he can't handle the grieving Kazusa on his own, breaks the cold war he has of Setsuna to ask her for help, being the only other person he knows that Kazusa has ever been anything close to friends with. And so, she tries to reconnect with Kazusa the only way a sheltered, preppy idol girl possibly could, a prospecting record deal, where the three work together to create a single to sell off the special issue of the magazine that Haruki works on. Which is less about the business end of things and more about Setsuna trying to find any way in which she can to enter Kazusa's heart again, eventually inciting her to give a moving speech that calls back to the bittersweet messaging of Koharu's end. She echoes Kazusa's feelings back to her, saying the loss of a dear family member is something that, at the time it happens, feels devastating. It feels as if your world is going to end and never recover, that a precious part of you has been shattered, you go through the motions, the funeral rites, the grieving that no one wants to experience, only to realize that not all is bad, that things aren't over. By talking to people, you begin to heal. By forming new connections to people, one can recover, and over time, the world that felt as if it had been shattered starts to turn again and heal. And while this would normally be the big emotional speech which marks a turning point in other VNs, the whole speech actually upsets Kazusa at that time, as she believes Setsuna is speaking from a fundamentally different position. She has a family, she has friends, she has Haruki, but what does Kazusa have? A mother who's slowly dying, and nothing else. Everyone else is going to forget her, including the one she loves most, knowingly stolen by the very woman trying to preach to her about life, so she, herself, does not have to experience grief. The two end up fighting, apologizing, and spilling out all their feelings that same night, continuing to meet for a few days as Setsuna tries to convince her of the value of their deal and provide emotional support, sometimes rambling about their shared frustrations and love for Haruki over a couple of drinks. But it's on one of the last of those days that Kazusa finally breaks. She cries into Setsuna's chest and let all of her fears pour out, of her sadness at being alone, of the creeping horror that the small world of hers will be shrinking into nothingness with the death of her mother, as Setsuna manages to take all of her sadness and fear of abandonment and use them to connect with the one she's hurt more than anyone else. No matter how much she feels about Kazusa, no matter how much love or hatred she feels in equal turns, no matter how Kazusa feels about Setsuna, no matter how much hatred or love she feels in equal turns, Setsuna still wants to take care of her. It is one of the most emotionally powerful scenes in the game, not just for showing Kazusa being more emotionally vulnerable than she had ever been before, but showing that deep down, despite all of her maladaptive coping mechanisms and tendency to harm others with them, Setsuna is someone who genuinely wants to help others and doesn't know how, but by God will she try where she can. Despite everything she had done to Kazusa to hurt her, and despite everything Haruki had done for her sake, and despite everything that Kazusa had done to Setsuna by her own inability to confess to her feelings, Setsuna still finds it in herself to hold her tight and use her pain as best she can to try and ease the suffering of someone who very might well hate her, because she knows the pain she's going through and doesn't want her to suffer. She doesn't want Kazusa to feel alone. It reinforces some genuinely touching emotional complexity to her character that had been present since the beginning, and something which I think reinforces the importance of her clearly being written as more than just a walking BPD stereotype like some critics claim her to be. If she were just that, then her entire character would probably just stop at abusing others for her own gain without any more depth to it. After all, that's the common stereotype of people with cluster B disorders as a whole. Nothing more than manipulative, destructive individuals who emotions don't even resemble that of other humans, if they're even humans. But, and while I do need to enforce from the beginning I'm not saying this to excuse abuse, people with cluster B disorders do the things they do generally out of a response to trauma and from learned maladaptive coping mechanisms. They're typically people who, like Setsuna, have suffered from living in families that are somewhere on the spectrum abusive, controlling, and manipulative, and have been repeatedly hurt throughout their lives. While not everyone develops destructive and manipulative habits as a result of abuse, a lot of people do develop attachment styles that lead them to simultaneously hate and love the people they're close to, fears of enmeshment and abandonment which cross and lead them to spend so much time reading deep into others' feelings that they end up with no conception of themselves, never given the time as a child to develop the necessary skills of self-insight. Like I hinted at earlier with my mention of scholarly discourse on this topic, many people with cluster B disorders are people who have some form of complex PTSD, which is where I fall, having formally exhibited enough of the behaviors to land a BPD diagnosis and having shaken off enough of the destructive ones to be clear of that, but still very clinically diagnosed with complex PTSD. I am far better than I used to be, and what few destructive habits I have left I know how to keep in check so they stay away as thoughts before I dissuade them, but I do still suffer from a lot of problems. And yet, at the core of that has always been a desire to make others happy while keeping myself safe. I haven't always known how to do the first, and I've been an absolute scumbag to many people in my life, prioritizing my fears over their freedom to make the decisions they wish to, but at no point did I ever explicitly want to hurt others for a reason that did not have a corrupted idea of their best interests in mind. I think it's this dichotomy that makes more extreme cases of Cluster B hard to understand for people, and Setsuna's character as well, because people really tend to conflate goodwill with pure goodness. People struggle to see Setsuna as anything but an emotionless, cruel-hearted abuser, because surely nobody would do what she did out of an earnest desire for happiness, right? The reality is, very few people set out to actively harm others, and accepting that is a major part of understanding how abuse functions for both the victim and the perpetrator. Emotional abuse often stems from a corrupted notion of what's best for someone else, and that is still abuse. The dichotomy is what makes abuse so insidious, because the goodwill makes it seem as if you're simply misunderstanding the person who's hurting you. Setsuna has good intentions deep down and genuinely wants to do good by the people around her. She wants to make the ones she cares for happy, even as she self-sabotages, believing herself to be unworthy, even as she manipulates others for her own safety that she thinks will make them happy too. This doesn't mean Setsuna is a princess like society makes her out to be, a pure of heart lady who simply needs some help. It makes her a flawed, fucked up, abusive mess of a person, but still a person, and as the ending to this route shows, there are no people who are beyond help if they make the realization they need it. With their record deal ending up in success, the free finishing recording in the nick of time, and Haruki managing to put his editing chops to work to finish the magazine their new single will be shipping with, Haruki and Kazusa, together in the recording room, settle their emotions and begin to move on from each other, before Haruki alone heads outside to meet with Setsuna in the snow, the one thing which always seems to be there for them in their most tumultuous times. Setsuna pressures Haruki to keep waiting for Kazusa to join them too, which he believes he can't do, as were they to be a group again, his feelings of love for her might continue to prosper. Despite him asking to be punished for this, Setsuna can't bring herself to do so, believing that a horrible woman like her shouldn't have the responsibility to punish another. And soon, we see where this self-hate is coming from. All of the texts that Haruki had been sending to Setsuna during his time cohabiting with Kazusa did have replies that she couldn't bring herself to send. Filled with love and hate, empathy and jealousy, all in mixed quantities, floods of complex emotions that hardly make sense to an observer, let alone to her. She doesn't even remember writing half of it, feeling half of it. All she knows is that she hates herself for having those extreme emotions and for not being the perfect girl she should be, but a bitter, scared person who lashes out at others in fear, building walls and tearing them down in equal turn to protect herself from the world around her. And yet, even knowing all of this, even seeing all of Setsuna's deepest and most painful emotions and how truly cruel her resentment for others can become, Haruki still loves her and accepts her for who she is, because he trusts Kazusa and he understands Kazusa. And Kazusa really does care about Setsuna. She wants him to be with Setsuna, and he trusts the assurance that he is not wrong to love Setsuna, even if it is unclear what parts of her emotions may be true or false, even though Setsuna does not understand who she is. Her own admission of not understanding her feelings is maybe the most key thing to understanding Setsuna as a character, and one that I very strongly felt, because truthfully, that's kind of what's been at the core of my own emotional struggles. Growing up in the kind of tumultuous, unstable, toxic household that festers these sort of destructive interpersonal traits forced me to grow up faster than I should have, and effectively ripped my childhood from me. I didn't get time to learn who I was when I was a kid and a teenager. I had to learn how to care for a mother who was someday suicidal and had others beaming with joy, how to deal with a father who was hardly present, and how to deal with a brother who almost unequivocally stuck up for my mother. Even just writing this sentence, I still feel some of the ticks I got from there, unable to not add qualifiers that absolve me of any certainty in my statements. When you grow up somewhere like that, a tiny little world which isolates you from places that allow you to grow and forces you to care for others above yourself, you don't get to learn what being a person is. You don't get to learn what's best for you. You don't get to learn what you want. You're forced to learn how to protect what little, fragile, childish emotions exist in you against an environment that is is convinced it knows what is best for you, an environment that in part spoils you and in part breaks you. Setsuna's household is shown to be something flawed in this way at multiple points. Her mother is a timid person that bends the will of her father, a man who has so little trust in her daughter that she won't even let her have full free will in her early 20s. Her brother, while often a very good boy who I'll not tolerate much slander of, is also capable of fits of extreme rage like Setsuna, even going as far as to physically beat the shit out of Haruki and Kazusa's true ending when he feels Haruki has wronged Setsuna by leaving her. Like, I love Takuhiro. He is generally a sweetheart, but someone please take him to a therapist because that household is not well. My key point in all of this, though, is that when you grow up in an environment that tries to strip you of your personhood, even by accident, you never actually get to grow an awareness of what your personhood is. You don't lose it, as so many people quick to demonize all people of cluster B disorders seem to think, but you certainly aren't given a chance to mature and flourish as you are forced to tend to others' broken beings. Because of this, I ended up developing a lot of those traits I had talked about before. Trying to manipulate situations for my own safety became a way of life. I learned to pay attention to every single little cue and read into what they might greater indicate because I wanted to avoid fights. I learned to watch what I said and craft words carefully for fear the smallest mistake may lead to a temporary collapse. I learned to shut my feelings down because showing them may cause others to fear. I learned to despise others at one moment for a perceived wrong and love them the next for a perceived right. And yet, when I left that environment and began to distance myself from the newest one which had recreated parts of it, I pretty quickly found that none of this was healthy. Constantly reading into others, constantly watching what I said, constantly trying to play four-dimensional chess with the people I talked to, constantly splitting with my emotions, was not just eating at me but actively ruining my ability to connect with other people and destroying them. Upon tearing those walls down though, and upon finally beginning to drop those defense mechanisms, I found that under them was a person that did not understand themselves. I had spent so long attempting to understand others and protect myself from them that I not only couldn't understand why I had adopted these behaviors and performed them, but I couldn't even understand my own emotions. It's been a journey trying to do so. And as I outlined in the Chiaki segment, fiction and writing have been incredible tools for me to frame them through, and without them, I don't think I would have made half the progress I have. The other half has come from having friends and a partner who understand that I'm just going to have severe mood swings sometimes and react strongly to things and go into brief episodes of extreme joy and extreme fear that I don't even understand myself. All people can do at those points is just hold me and keep me safe from myself. But what's important here is that this journey to trying to better myself started with that simple admission. The painful, sickening, brutal realization that I simply did not know myself because I had never been given a chance to. And that's kind of why I counter the idea that Setsuna's ending is a fairy tale ending, because her stating this is not some small thing. Does this still conclude with her making up with Kazusa, marrying Haruki, and living happily ever after? Yeah, sure, but, and maybe I'm reading too deep into it, maybe not, I see her admission of her greatest fault as not only a moment of incredible self-realization, but the beginning of her starting the long journey to improve herself. It is the only way Setsuna's character could end positively and foster a healthy relationship with Haruki and Kazusa, an acceptance that she is not a princess and never has been. She has to grow, just as all of us do. If Setsuna's ending is seen as fairy-tale-esque, then the two Kazusa has must be everything from a bittersweet collapse to a gut-wrenching return to form. While we'll get to her true ending shortly, as it does manage to put all the themes of the game together and wrap up what's left, her bad ending, referred to often as the infidelity ending, is maybe the most painful in the whole game. Within it, Haruki opts not to faithfully pursue his feelings for Kazusa, nor to reconcile and work with Setsuna to become emotionally honest and mature people, but to instead repeat the same mistake he made towards the end of IC, cheating on Setsuna with Kazusa, the two of them escaping into each other's comfort as they tried to run from their lives. Haruki goes to some truly batshit lengths to maintain a facade of being with Setsuna while still dedicating as much time as he can to Kazusa, even going as far as to craft a code system with her, placing pretend work phone calls with keywords hidden within them to indicate his availability on any given night. The reason he doesn't just honestly break up with Setsuna instead of doing all this, though, is because Kazusa is thoroughly convinced his future lays only with Setsuna. She will be nothing more in his life than an affair, brief flickers of happiness left to stir mutually in their memories. And as for her reason to persist in this, she's scared to be left alone, perhaps best embodied in a scene where she holds him gently under the soft light of the moon and begins to sob as he falls asleep, afraid he may leave her. The two's desire to spend time with each other and fear of separation leads to them forming an isolated lifestyle, becoming hikikomori together. Kazusa abandons her piano training for a time and Haruki opts to work indoors, attempting to excuse it to his work as having a cold and needing to stay home. And of course, despite trying to hide it from Setsuna too, she she's damn well aware after a friend of hers did some snooping and informs her of the result. Love Tomo, by the way, great Ojo-sama. I haven't praised her nearly enough, but she's a great side character who appears at the end of CC and goes for Coda. Anyways, where it all ends is the two going on a trip to the same resort they went to during introductory chapter of Setsuna, as they now play pretend as a married couple, just the two of them this time. For a short period, for just a couple of days, the two manage to achieve a facade of a perfect, loving couple they always wished to be, embracing each other under vows taken without ordination, ending only when Kazusa leaves on the final day, telling Haruki that things between them could never work out, but that she treasures those days she spent as his wife. At the end of it all, she manages to put on a stunning piano concert for Japan, thanks to the love Haruki had given her, as both him and Setsuna watch him leaving at the end after confessing to the whole affair. Despite Setsuna's hurt at the time, though, she still ends up accepting him back months later, unable to bring herself to leave him behind. Once again, bringing us back to where closing chapter ended. This ending is a perfect manifestation of the point which Setsuna's CC ending brings up, that if none of these people are put into a situation that forces them to reflect on their flaws and grow, they just won't. All their worlds are too small, too dim to ever grow if they fail to try and aim higher. Haruki will always be an indecisive cheater, Setsuna will always be a desperate manipulator, and Kazusa will always be a fool who believes her wishes to be impossible and runs from them. What I love here is the length it shows these characters willing to go to maintain these uncomfortable yet familiar status quo. Haruki is so afraid of making progress that he'll do something which eats at everybody around him and reaffirms to him and others that he can be a truly deplorable person, because being deplorable is easier than working towards progress. Setsuna is so desperate to not be left behind that she'll go back to a man who has betrayed her multiple times, even as she knows for a fact that she's never going to be anything more than a number two to him, because that is easier than rebuilding. She admits this at multiple points, most prominently during Mari's ending, where she begs Haruki in tears to not abandon her, saying she'd be completely fine being his side girl. For her, in her broken emotional state, that would be preferable to reliving the trauma of her abandonment. And finally, Kazusa is so desperate for warmth, yet so convinced of her worthlessness as nothing more than a pianist with no social or life experience, that she'll chase the same dream again and again, never having the courage to make it reality. After all, she sees Setsuna as the only one right for Haruki. She sees her as the one and only true heroine. Those brief moments of warmth seem to be enough for her to be satisfied in the moment, even if she desires more, most embodied in the very feverish adult scenes. And for the record, a lot of the 18 plus content in Coda is like this, the only sincere content coming within the last moments of Setsuna's true ending. Haruki having sex with Setsuna during the Coda common route often feels less like two lovers embracing, and more like two people afraid of losing their bond and using sex to reinforce it, and everything in this ending feels like two people embracing at what they believe to be the end. If this sounds familiar to what I discussed in Koharu's route, that's because it is. Though unlike in her ending, the more actively looming presence of Setsuna here and the more mutually romantic bent to their relationship here makes it all feel more like a tragedy that will inevitably collapse instead of an immature mutual spiral that can be climbed out of. Unlike Koharu's route, which you know is going to end in something vaguely hopeful as it is a heroine's true end, this is blatantly a bad ending, and because it's White Album 2, you know the closure to it is going to be Haruki and Setsuna once again stuck in their loop of mutual self-harm. It's exactly because of that marking as a bad ending though that I think it manages to avoid contrasting with the rest of the game. You know it's not going to be happy because it is structurally a false ending. It's a what if that exists to reinforce the point that these people have not grown enough yet to avoid making these same mistakes. The only way for them to avoid them is to go a step further, to finally cross the boundaries they never could have before, yet should have long ago. Kazusa's true ending is the ultimate thematic conclusion to the story of White Album 2. It's the one which forces Haruki to decide for himself what he wants most, even as it means being willing to upend everything he's known for the last 5 years of his life, and even as it means taking leaps bigger than he ever thought he'd be able to take. But when I say that Haruki has to be willing to upend everything here, I do mean everything, as he burns damn near every single one of his bridges in pursuit of being with Kazusa, losing not just Setsuna, but his friends who have sorta kinda not really stood by him this whole time. Given how much I've talked about the fetishization of the idea of relationships up to this point, and the image their friends have of him and Setsuna as a perfect hetero couple, I think there's a very clear theme here of learning when it's right to break off from society's wishes and pursue your own, though it's explored with respect to just how painful of a process that is. Some of my favorite conversations in the game are contained in this ending, like Takeya confronting Haruki personally after their other friends snap on him, and him practically pleading in tears for Haruki not to leave Setsuna behind, not especially after proposing to her and the plans being known to her family. Despite despite the way she treats Haruki, everyone still sees her as the main heroine, the perfect woman, and Haruki's decision is tantamount to choosing an incomplete romance of a good-for-nothing nobody. Even Kazusa shares this perception to some extent, as mentioned briefly a moment ago. To say nothing of the other ways in which she views herself as lesser than Setsuna's perfect image, she admits to believing she's nothing more than a side character who stole Haruki from the one he's destined to be with. And to say something of those other ways, she doesn't know she's the right one to be with, given what her sheltered background has led to her becoming. She's lived her entire life in a world that's separate from what average people live in, only given the briefest of glimpses by flickers of warmth from her otherwise detached mother, and moments of closeness with the rare people who could break through her barriers like Haruki and Setsuna. It's a world that's taken away her ability to learn how to bond with other people at a young age, reinforcing its own existence by damaging the one it depends on, and one that Kazusa believes may very well be incompatible with her desire to live a more normal life. To say the least, this sheltering has left Kazusa as a very immature person, like Haruki and Setsuna are, except further compounded by that environment. She's prone to bouts of anger, she expresses herself by crying a lot, she doesn't really know how to manage herself, she's socially awkward, she's lacking in any skills except piano, and she's generally inept at everything in life. She confesses all of this to Haruki at multiple points, in what I feel are by far some of the most emotionally raw scenes of any route, as well as one that leads to them effectively making a pact in blood to solve the problem with Setsuna and live a life together. This has to be one of the most memorable CGs ever, and alone is worth playing True Root for. Still, I don't repeat all these things to disparage her or start a waifu war. I acknowledge them out of sympathy because that's pretty much the exact position I found myself when I came out of my parents' home. I couldn't cook, I knew only some basic cleaning, I couldn't talk to people in person worth a damn, I had no life skills, and I was generally a dysfunctional wreck. I more or less just looked pretty, was good at sex, and was good with video editing and music production, but those are hardly daily life skills, except maybe the sex one. Where Kazusa is wrong about herself is the idea that this invalidates her as a person or makes her less lovable, something which Haruki insists on being false throughout the route. He knows that Kazusa is someone who lacks skills, he knows that she's someone who can go into fits, and he knows that she's someone who has only ever truly learned one thing, but he doesn't see her as any less of a person despite that. If anything, it makes her more of a normal person than she claims to be because she's flawed and knows she's flawed. And yet, despite that, the entire cast holds onto this belief that her being like this, her having grown up in a world separate from what Haruki et al. Are familiar with, is a reason why she can never truly be a part of their lives. Haruki as well seems to believe this, and seems to believe that the only way to be with her is to abandon what he's known. He quits his job and seems to believe that no one will care. He talks with his friends, who are all convinced this is him throwing his life away, so those bridges become burnt, even with his bro Takeya. He talks to Setsuna's family, who ends up banishing him, and in the case of their son, as mentioned before, physically beat him in enraged disappointment, only stopped by his father saying not to attack someone who's not a part of the family. Which, like, I'm sorry, but what the fuck does this family do to each other when they have problems? And last of all, he talks to Setsuna, who still can't imagine him and Kazusa having any relation to her that's not akin to what they had in IC, and desperately believes this to be still obtainable. She's stuck in her past, and Haruki is foolishly set on the idea that him and Kazusa can only exist in a quiet little world, one which is fundamentally different from Setsuna's. She's surrounded by the warmth of her friends and family, but what do him and Kazusa have? Neither of them have family they're deeply connected to, neither of them believe they have friends anymore, all they believe they have is each other. Where this scene leads, after the two separate and Haruki goes off to a bar for the night, is Kazusa taking her turn on cutting ties, confronting Setsuna herself and admitting to her feelings for Haruki, as well as to her feelings of self-resentment for not having the courage to confess to Haruki before Setsuna did. Viewing herself as responsible for everything that happened up to this point, for deeply wounding Setsuna by taking Haruki, she attempts to stab her own hands with a broken glass as self-punishment, until Setsuna stops her by knocking it out of her hand. Besides this tying into what I was talking about earlier, about Setsuna still caring about Kazusa even if she has mixed feelings on her, Kazusa's willingness to injure herself to be with the one she wants most reveals a lot about her mentality. The glimmer of light that Haruki represents, a chance for her world to grow into something greater than it's ever been, a normalcy she could never obtain, is enough for her to be willing to punish herself and atone for supposed sins, to cast aside the only other world she has ever known. Though Haruki and Kazusa both share this false belief for a time, that their happiness can only be found through an equal exchange, what changes his perspective is, on the very same night as all this, everyone from work coming to give him a farewell party at the bar. Despite believing himself to have severed everything, despite believing himself to have no ties to Japan anymore, he clearly had left an impact on people whom he only briefly knew, and not so well at that. Despite thinking he had to throw away everything to gain Kazusa, that impromptu party, made on a guess of where Haruki would be that night, showed him that he didn't have to lose everything important to pursue this new life. And that that is what he conveys to Kazusa after they finally meet again on that tragic night. To throw away the thinking that one has to discard something precious to gain something precious. By the end, Haruki and Kazusa realize that they don't have to live in a tiny bubble of a world, and Setsuna does as well, as her very final parting of Haruki has her accepting that though things are over, that she'll still be okay. Because her friends, her family, her co-workers, everyone is there to protect her and stand up for her. No matter what great wound she takes on, she can and will heal. It is with that that Haruki and Kazusa are finally ready to leave behind Japan, bringing their most precious memories and possessions with them. Although, Haruki did forget one thing, his beloved little guitar, one which he used to connect with his former love. But even that is not truly forgotten, as 2 years later, the couple receive an email from Kazusa's mother, a video forwarded from their old friends in Japan, of Setsuna playing the song Powder Snow on Haruki's guitar.
Wie geht es Ihnen? Ich singe immer noch.
People claim this to be the true ending to White Album 2 as a story, the Haruki ending even, and I can't help but agree. Seeing Haruki find the courage to make progress even as it's terrifying, seeing him take massive steps to pursue what he wants most, and seeing him accept that the person he loves is someone who barely understands herself beyond one small thing, feels like a perfect embodiment of all the themes that have been explored up to this point with a very hopeful culmination. I've seen some say this ending has Haruki sacrificing everything, but I feel like the entire point of it is that the concept never had to be true in the first place, and may not even be. The idea of leaving everything was nothing more than an idea which the characters had been convinced was true for their own inability to imagine anything for Haruki but what would be most logical for him by society's standards. However, as shown by the details of Setsuna and Haruki's relationship, that was never logical to begin with. While outwardly appearing healthy, their relationship embodied everything that could be terrible in one. They were two deeply damaged people whose flaws hurt each other time and time again, putting on a facade of perfection to appease those around them, unable to re-examine their relationship by the pressures and assumptions of the society they grew up in. In order for Haruki and Kazusa to grow, they had to escape those expectations and do what was right for them. It is only by questioning the fundamental notions of what is right for somebody that somebody can find what is right for them. Which then leads me to ask, can Haruki only have a relationship with Kazusa by burning all of his bridges? Is leaving Setsuna necessarily throwing everything away? As this ending shows, the answer to both of those questions doesn't have to be yes, because the people who threatened to cut the bonds with him did so because they were so focused on that forlorn love. The only reason Haruki lost Takeya et al. Was for their own stubbornness, and the loss was not an inevitability as proven by how dearly his co-workers cared for him despite it all. Hell, whether or not Haruki did lose everyone is something I'm not even sure of. They clearly care enough about him still to have Setsuna's video forwarded through Kazusa's mother. Perhaps, in some ways, time healed their wounds. And as for the fears that everything would be destroyed that everyone is throwing around, well, their life still went on. Everyone pursued their own careers and wishes and even found success in their respective careers. Even Setsuna, though struggling to let go of her past, embodied in the lyrics of Powder Snow, is clearly still pushing on and moving forward bit by bit with those around her. She may not be able to let go of Haruki fully, but she is certainly growing. Is it perfectly happy? No, because moving forward is never a perfectly happy thing. Not even in Setsuna's ending is it, as the acceptance of her emotional immaturity and lack of self-understanding is seemingly one of the most painful moments for her. Moving forward inevitably means you will leave things behind. It means you're going to change things and give up on the familiarity that had embraced your life up to that point. Moving forward means making decisions that will irrevocably change your life. Moving forward means re-evaluating everything from little details to lifelong friendships, but it only has to mean leaving everything behind you if you and those around you believe it must. Progress is an inevitable, insatiable thing that is always lurking around the corner. Time will stop for nobody, but that is not an inherently bad thing, because time is magical. Through it, all can come to pass, and our wounds, should we confess to them, should we trust others to help us, can heal.
This is something that, in this stage of my life, I think was important for me to hear. As I write the script and am now voicing and filming it, I'm in the middle of planning to fly over the ocean to live in another country for a sizable portion of the year, as well as in the middle of planning where I'll be in the US until I move away from it. I've had some of the most difficult conversations of my life in these past few months, and I've made decisions that, financially, personally, emotionally, are massive commitments that will irrevocably change my relationship to those in the world around me, which I can't undo. I've been moving forward in ways I never thought I would and escaped a discomforting stillness that had become my norm. In fact, I've done it multiple times. I've expanded the little world I live into something greater and realized I don't have to throw away everything that existed in my original isolated world to be a part of it. I can still be myself and live for something greater. And by sheer accident, I've kind of documented that for my videos. Everything I've had to wade through in order to take those risks and grow, though painful, has been worth it. And with time, that pain has healed, because all can and will come to pass. And through that passage, the beautiful can only become more radiant.
Clocking in at over 75 hours of playtime, White Album 2 is one of the longest works of fiction I've gone through, and that's without even touching all of the side content that exists. I know people are gonna tell me I should have played the mini after stories and other things for this video, but my gender undefined sibling in Christ, please look at how long this video has already gotten. I am a very tired video editor, writer, voicer, scripter person thingy, but unlike many other longer works I've experienced that feel unnecessarily so, it's not just a brilliantly paced work that makes almost every second count, but a deeply impactful and resonant one too. Despite some shortcomings here and there, and some very lacking production quality in places, Maruto et al. Managed to put together something that stands out amidst a sea of interesting and clever romance novels. It is truly the soap opera to rule them all, taking tropes we all know and love or hate and reworking them into something that shows us the greatest and worst in humanity. Whether you adore or despise the cast, there's no denying they're some of the most fascinating characters within this genre of story, and really within the whole genre of visual novels, I'd wager. Like, I've read a ton of games that stuck with me, but there are few that have so thoroughly implanted themselves into my brain and stirred up every emotion within me like the main cast here has. And the good news is, like I said in the intro, this game is pretty easy to get a hold of despite only ever officially being released in Japan. There is always a digital version if you're willing to go through a bunch of hoops, and the sponsor of this video, Zen Market, offers a pretty slick proxy service that makes importing the game and associated materials a breeze. Even taking away the potential bias that their support gives me, that's still the route I suggest going for the game. Oh, and of course it's got decent English TL, that helps too. Would I recommend playing it? Yeah, absolutely! Whether you are a het-brained romance core monogamy chad, or an ascended bisexual polycule fiend, or somewhere in between, White Album 2 offers enough criticism and commentary of how we form bonds and relationships to appeal to anyone regardless of their stances on relationships, and the themes besides that are utterly incredible. It's a game that, through hardship and reward, through pain and happiness, shows that anyone can grow. And that growth, though painful, does not mean losing all dear in your life. What we know, and the people around us, can change, and we can change with it. The pain we may experience for that can and will fade, because time is magical. With that magic, we can overcome anything and pursue what we wish for the most, even if society wishes otherwise.